a good idea.
Thank you.
All right, well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Bombardier 2016 Investor Day. My name is Patrick Ghoche. I'm Vice President of Investor Relations, and I recognize a lot of familiar faces that I've met over my first year at Bombardier. I want to welcome you all, you know, including those that are following us live on the webcast. We have a very good turnout today and a really full agenda. You'll hear today from obviously our CEO, CFO, our transformation officers, and also from our four business unit leaders, so, you know, a full day. You probably saw the press release we issued last night with the 2017 guidance, so we'll definitely cover that in detail, give you more color, and the whole story behind it. So for those joining us on the webcast, the presentation is available at ir.bombardier.com. So just maybe a couple of housekeeping notes before we begin the formal presentation. I'd like to remind you that during the course of this Investor Day, we may make projections or other forward-looking statements regarding future events or the future financial performance of the corporation. Several assumptions were made by Bombardier in preparing these statements, and we wish to emphasize that there are risks that actual events or results may differ materially from these statements. And for additional information on such statements or assumptions, we please refer you to the MD&A released in early November. So please note I'm making those cautionary statements on the behalf of each speaker whose remarks today contain forward-looking statements. That being said, we're really thrilled to have you here this morning. We have seven presentations. We'll have two blocks. The first block will have Alain, John, Jim, and Nico. Focus on strategy, obviously, on our operations, but also on the financials. We'll have a Q&A session just after that. We'll try to focus it, you know, very high-level strategy financials, and have a second Q&A session at the end of the morning, just before we break for lunch, and there we'll have all the speakers available for a Q&A. So, and we'll take both questions from the room and on the web. So on that, we're ready to begin.
I'm the CEO of Bombardier. Before we get going, I'd like to start by introducing the team. I'll ask the team member to introduce themselves, starting with John.
CFO.
Good morning, Vounassis, Chief Transformation Officer.
Good morning, Nico, Chief Procurement Officer.
Good morning, Laurent, Troger, President of Transportation.
Good morning, Sylvain Lévesque, Corporate Strategy.
Well, thank you, guys. So it has been a year since our last Investor Day here in New York, and as you will see today, we have made huge progress in 2016. We are on track right now to deliver on our 2016 financial commitments well within guidance. Our turnaround plan is in full motion. In fact, we have successfully completed the first phase of our plan, the de-risking phase, and you can already see the early benefits of our actions well reflected in our 2017 guidance, and John will cover this in a little bit more detail. And we are very well positioned for solid top-line growth over the five-year plan. So we have the right strategy in place, and we have a very strong leadership team executing it and unleashing value. So what we'll do today with you is we will share in great detail what we've done in 2016 and how we will continue to drive strong business performance. So let's start with a brief overview of the business. Bombardier is a $16 billion business with four great franchises. We have one of the broadest and newest product offering in rail transportation. That's an $8 billion business. We have one of the best business aircraft franchises in the world with revenues of $5.5 billion. Our commercial aircraft business is growing with the successful entry into service of the C-Series. And we have world-class design and manufacturing capabilities in aerostructured. So there's tremendous value in Bombardier's portfolio. We have been investing massively over the past few years in both trains and planes. And what we will share with you today is our plan to unlock this value by executing programs flawlessly, by aggressively reducing costs, by leveraging our scale of a $16 billion business, and also by taking advantage of our growth markets. As you recall, we've shared with you last year a five-year turnaround plan with three phases. Well, in 2016, we have successfully completed the first and critical phase of de-risking the business. So we have stabilized the business. I mean, we have positioned ourselves for a successful 2017, and we have set a strong foundation for growth. And I am very proud of the team, and I'm very proud of what we've achieved in 2016. So first, on liquidity front, with the execution of the $1.4 billion bond deal last month, we now have the right level of liquidity to execute our plan. We have de-risked our aero skyline by proactively adjusting production rates in line with market demand. A major achievement in 2016 was the certification of the C-Series, both models, the CS100 and the CS300. And they are both in service today and performing extremely well. In business aircraft, our new Global 7000 flew for the first time on November 4th, and the program is now in full flight test mode. And again, our turnaround plan is in full motion, and that will be covered in more detail by Jim and Nico and John and the rest of the team. So, great progress in 2016, and I'm pretty pleased to say that what we've committed to do, we've done in 2016. So at this stage now, our focus is shifting to building earnings power and generating better, stronger free cash flow. Our operational transformation is already producing solid results. We are tackling all aspects of cost, from SG&A, product costs, site optimization. We're driving efficiency and productivity across the entire business. We're also looking at the portfolio. We're assessing strategy. We're looking at opportunities. And now that we have the certification of the C-Series behind us, I mean, we are focused on the Global 7000. And moving forward, we have a placeholder of $1 billion per year for new programs over the five-year plan. We have a great engineering organization today led by François. We've learned a lot over the past few years. And what we're doing today is we're leveraging these learnings. We're building best practices. We're establishing standard work to be more efficient when we develop new programs moving forward. And obviously, we will remain very disciplined with capital allocation. Finally, another major piece of our earnings growth here will come from solid conversion on the powerful top-line growth in front of us. Our 2020 objective is to grow revenues to $25 billion. That is a solid CAGR of 10% plus. And it's actually a pretty simple story. I mean, there will be four major drivers of that growth that the team will talk to you about in greater detail. But the first one being the C-Series. The C-Series is the best aircraft in its class, you know, bar none, in the 100 to 150 seat class. And we have a solid backlog, you know, through 2020. Fred will cover this in more detail. Our new Global 7000 will enter service in 2018 with also a very strong backlog, and we continue to see very strong customer interest today. This will be the best business aircraft in the industry in the world, and David will talk more about that. Our transportation business has a great product portfolio, a global presence, and a $31 billion backlog. And we see strong market growth moving forward. So this will be covered by Laurent. He will share with you how he's planning to leverage the portfolio and continue the transformation of his business. And finally, aftermarket. Just to put it in perspective, we have more than 4,500 business jets flying today. We have close to 3,000 commercial aircraft flying. We have more than 100,000 train cars in operation around the world. So the fact is, we have a very large installed base. And in 2016, with the team, we started to increase focus on aftermarket. One, providing more value to customer, but secondly, you know, capturing more maintenance, parts, and service activities to drive solid aftermarket revenue growth. So let me conclude by reaffirming our commitment to our 2020 goals. Now that we have de-risked the business and that we have the right level of liquidity to execute our plan, we are entirely focused on growing revenues, earnings, and free cash flow. We are still on track to become a $25 billion business by 2020 with a 7 to 8% ROS. I mean, that's 500 basis points of margin expansion. And this would be creating very strong value. And our 2017 guidance is a strong step towards achieving our 2020 goal. So I am very proud of what we've done in 2016. We have some more work to do, but we have a good plan in place. So I am confident in our strategy, in our strong leadership team, in our great employees, and in our ability to unleash value for customers and for shareholders as well. So I want to thank you on this. I will now turn it over to John.
Good morning, everybody, and it's great to be here. So about a year ago, we were here in New York, and we presented our turnaround plan, and we laid out the 2018 and 2020 objectives. And shortly after that, we presented our 2016 guidance, and we described the key actions that would turn this business around, a three-phase plan. We were de-risking the business, rebuilding earnings and cash flow, and deleveraging the balance sheet in the longer term. Today, a year later, I'm glad to be able to say that we're executing on that plan, and that we're on track to meet all of our objectives as we stated them last year. 2016 has been a year of important milestones. We've accomplished a lot, we've improved performance, and we de-risked the business. We've also set a strong foundation for 2017 earnings and cash flow acceleration, and we're gonna talk to you a little bit about that today. Our 2016 accomplishments have established a liquidity strength that clears a runway for value creation as we improve the business, and as our new products drive top-line growth. Today, I think we have a lot of very powerful momentum in the business. So maybe turn it over and look at 2016 first. There's nothing new in the numbers I'm showing you here this morning. It's essentially the guidance we provided in our Q3 call in November. What's important is to take a step back and just observe a little bit of the progress we've made. If you start on the left side of the chart, you'll see that EBIT will come in between $350 and $400 million, and that's at the top end of our guidance range. If you remember when we set this guidance early in the year in 16, it was $200 to $400 million, and at that time, we still had to certify the CS300. We were in the midst of ramping up production and preparing for entry into service. Our global 7000 was still in the pre-test phase, and we were still adjusting our business jet franchise to lower production levels. Our results demonstrate strong execution, and they delivered the early benefits of our transformation during what we characterize as a transition year. We also, in 2016, experienced free cash flow improvement of about $500 million versus 2015. And we continue to progress towards our 2018 free cash flow break-even objective. Our business unit margins are expanding across the board versus last year. With the exception of commercial aircraft, the BU margins are all above 6%, and the average ROS growth improvement has been 100 to 200 basis points in every segment. In transportation, we've grown 100 basis points, and we've done this while we managed working capital very tightly, generating free cash flow. We've grown 150 basis points in business aircraft, and we did this on a revenue reset that we had planned earlier in 15. I think what's interesting to note here is that on $1.5 billion of less revenue in business aircraft, we will deliver more EBIT in 2016 than we did in 2015. We've grown our aerostructures and engineering margins by 200 basis points, and we've done this while we've ramped up the C-Series wing and cockpit production, and this is coming from the efforts that Jean is having on his organization in taking out cost. Let's talk about commercial aircraft. Their EBIT will come in $100 million better than our original guidance of a $550 million loss. And the improved expectations are simply a product of hitting all of our program milestones and great aircraft performance in the field. 2016 performance is evidence that we're transforming the company and transforming the company so it can perform in any market environment. So, as we enter 2017, the second year of our five-year plan, we're coming in with lots of confidence. We've launched the initiatives and we've taken the proactive actions that are necessary to support our target performance, and we're confident in our ability to execute. In 2017, we'll resume growth after resetting activity levels in both planes and trains in 2016. We're essentially maintaining current production rates into the first half of 2017, and then we'll grow prudently in the second half as we prepare for 2018 growth. We expect total consolidated revenues to increase between 1 and 3%. And you'll see by the details of each business unit later in today's presentations, some of the background to those growth projections. Our earnings will significantly improve to between $530 and $630 million, representing a profit growth from the midpoint of 50% or more. Many of the initiatives to grow our profits have already been put into place, and you've seen that, including announcements we made earlier this year in restructuring. For the second consecutive year, free cash flow will improve in 2017 by $400 million. We're going to reach, we'll spend $750 to $1 billion in cash flow in 2017, even as we maintain capitalized investments at a stable level versus 16. So basically, it's coming from operating cash flow improvements. Another way to look at 2017 cash flows, and I think this is important, is that there's essentially three strategic capital allocations that we're making in the year. One to new products, revenue ramp-up, and cost reduction. So if I summarize that for you, we'll spend $300 million in restructuring in 2017. That's $150 million more than we did in 16, but a $300 million cash outflow in the year. We're completing the peak investment cycle in aerospace with the Global 7000, and we'll spend about $1.4 billion in CapEx. And to put that in perspective, that's about $400 million above our targeted long-term capital investment rate of about $1 billion from 19 and forward. So in a sense, a bit of a non-recurring CapEx. And finally, we'll spend about $400 million to continue to ramp up the C-Series, and that's in line with our plan to break even by 2020 and within the $2 billion envelope that we talked to cash break even. Consistent with restructuring expenses in 2016, we expect special charges in the range of $250 to $300 million, and the cash impact of those charges is already reflected in the free cash flow guidance that I've provided. I'll take some time now to go over the 2017 plan guidance and as well as a roadmap to 2018 and 2020 performance. Let's start with revenues. So in 2016, we'll remain disciplined in matching production with demand, as we did in 2015. We continue to navigate current markets by protecting brand value, by managing working capital, and by retaining strong market share in each of our segments. In 2017, we'll resume growth now that we've set in place strong recovery plans for key projects, as well as normalized working capital management practices at BT. Business aircraft will absorb the revenue impacts of adjusting our Learjet production to approximately 10 aircraft in 2017, and that's down about a dozen units from 2016. Business aircraft year-over-year reductions, revenue reductions also reflect the better-than-expected deliveries in 2016, which will now be over 150 units. Commercial aircraft growth reflects the C-Series ramp-up to about 30 to 35 units, and that's offset by a trim of Q400 and CRJ deliveries. We expect in total at business at commercial aircraft between 80 and 85 aircraft deliveries. In aerostructures and engineering, we'll have growth supported by C-Series and early the ramp-up of the C-Series to the 30, 35 units, as well as the pre-production for 2018, and the early unit ramp-up for the Global 7000 in the back end of the year. As we go into 2018, we see revenues of between $18 and $20 billion as we continue to ramp up C-Series. Our 2020 revenue targets of $25 billion is supported by strong backlogs, by new production introduction, new product introduction, and a large installed base that produces strong aftermarket revenues. And on the next chart, I'll show you some of the details about how we get to $25 billion. Bombardier is a growth story. Over the next 4 years, our revenues will grow significantly. We'll add $9 billion to our top line and reach $25 billion by 2020. Both the C-Series and the Global 7000 will have achieved normal production rates in that year. Our growth story doesn't rely on any significant rebounds in either markets or macroeconomic conditions. Rather, we're leveraging the strong product investments we've made and the deep installed base that we have in service. You'll see from this chart that we're building from a reset year in 2016. That's a revenue low point in our cycle. And if you look from left to right, you'll see where it's coming from. $3 billion coming from C-Series volumes at between 90 and 120 aircraft, as per plan. We'll add $3 billion for the Global 7000 with deliveries of over 40 units in 2020. Our transportation franchise continues to grow mid-single digits. From $8 billion to $10 billion, it'll add $2 billion to the top line. And we're leveraging a strong backlog, consistent book-to-bill of over one, and the best product offering in the industry. And finally, with over 7,000 aircraft in service and 100,000 train cars in operation, we expect to grow aftermarket revenues from about $3 billion this year to $4 billion in 2020, adding $1 billion in aftermarket revenues. We'll talk a little bit about earnings now. If you see here, there's a roadmap from 16 to 17 and then to 20. Our earnings roadmap shows how the transformation is impacting our margins and expanding them in 17 and 18. And then that's before we combine it with strong top-line growth that creates really powerful operating leverage on earnings. In 2017, the largest contribution to earnings growth will come from our restructuring actions and transformation. And we'll be adding about $150 million of margin from our transformation programs, including those restructuring activities. Volume and some favorable mix will add a little bit of a positive to conversion. And we're also starting to see some of the benefits of FX coming through our P&L as we start to roll off past hedges and as we turn over inventories that embed those positive FX rates. Now, if we take a step back and we exclude the $400 million loss from the normal ramp-up of the C-Series, you can conclude that EBIT in 2017 will approach $1 billion net of the C-Series ramp-up costs. That's almost 6% margins across the business already at this point of the transformation, which is early in our five-year plan. If you look forward to 2017, from a midpoint of about $580 million, we can see a plan and draw a path to the 2020 EBIT of $1.75 plus billion dollars. And the way we're going to get to the 175 or more is from, one, converting revenue from growth. So we'll see that revenue convert to profitability at current margins. So that's in the neighborhood of 2017 margins across the business units. We'll do that by achieving our break-even on the C-Series. And I've talked about the C-Series. You'll see guidance for commercial aircraft, roughly $400 million. So as that moves through, will also generate the benefits of moving out through the normal learning curve. And finally, we'll expand margins to 7 to 8%. And as we expand those margins through transformation and restructuring, we'll see more earnings and earnings growth towards that $2 billion target. Jim will take you through the details of our transformation. I think what's important to know is that we've already put in place the actions that are going to drive a lower cost structure. I'm going to switch gears and give you a little bit of detail on our aerospace programs. I think this is a question that I receive often from you. So there's a little bit of background here on how they impact our cash flows in 2017. So first, we continue to hit all of our milestones. And as such, we're on plan to achieve our target long-term investment of about $1 billion in 2019 and onward. In 2017, C-Series cash usage will drop from just over $1 billion, as I talked about on the Q3 call, and as we guided in the full year at the beginning of the year, to about $400 million in 2017. So this represents about $650 million of improved free cash flows. And remember, our objective of $2 billion in the C-Series to break even in 2020. So what that means is that at the end of 2017, we'll be a long way through that journey. About $1.5 billion spent at the end of this year, 17, with the remainder to go as we break even in 2020, about $500 million left. The global 7,000 development program will consume about $350 million in more cash in 2017 than we did in 2016 as we execute the flight test program, and we'll be adding flight test vehicles to the program as well. Later in the year, in 2017, we'll also start to build up the working capital required for 2018 entry into service. So that'll have some working capital impacts as well. Overall, we expect CapEx levels to remain neutral in 2017, with 2016 at about $1.4 billion of CapEx. Working capital will show a net improvement from these programs of about $300 million on a year-over-year basis, generating positive cash flow impacts. So if we look at 17 and 18 cash flow in more detail, I can show you how we get to our 2017 target, as well as the roadmap to our free cash flow break-even in 2018. In 2017, we take another important step. We'll have a reduction of about $400 million of consumption of cash. Again, for a second consecutive year, material improvement, almost an aggregate about $1 billion in over those 2 years of cash flow usage reduction. The first thing you'll see on this chart is that the $300 million I talked about on the two programs is a benefit from 2016 levels, so down about $300 million the way I described it a minute ago on that prior chart. You also notice that we're self-funding the restructuring initiatives that we're taking on. And we're doing this through working capital efficiencies, and those are working capital efficiencies coming outside of the programs fundamentally from transportation, the way we have in 2016, but also from the legacy aerospace businesses. And Jim will talk more about that working capital efficiency plan. So neutral between restructuring and working capital efficiencies in terms of cash flow. And then finally, we'll convert earnings to profit. So we have a step up in earnings in 2017, and that will largely convert to cash flows. And that takes us to $750 to $1 billion of usage. We have a clear plan to achieve our target. And I mentioned it before, but I'll mention it again. The $750 to $1 billion is operating strength and capital allocation towards, one, continue to ramp up our volumes on C-Series, which will eventually bring profitable growth. Two, is continue to invest in a state-of-the-art Global 7000. And three, we're going to fund our cost reduction programs. So what's even more important here is that there's a roadmap, a clear roadmap for 2018 free cash flow break-even, and it's firmly in place, and I show it to you here. Investment in CapEx will continue to come down as we navigate through the Global 7000. And in 2018, we expect that to produce another couple of hundred million dollars of positive free cash flow impacts versus the 17 levels. So down down from 17 to 18, about $200 million is our expectation. Restructuring initiatives will be largely behind us. We'll still have some restructuring spend in 18, but we expect about $150 million improvement year over year from 17 to 18. So that draws another reduction in cash flow usage. And finally, C-Series cash flow usage will continue to come down as we gravitate towards a break-even in 1920, and that will produce additional cash flow reduction towards our break-even in 18. So those three components were the fundamental components. Add to that earnings conversion again, and in 2018, we've set out targets of 5 to 6% margins, which are another step up from 17 earnings, and those earnings, again, will convert to cash flows. So that's the roadmap to the break-even on 2018 cash. Now, to be clear, our objectives are to be beyond break-even, and that's what we're going to be doing towards our 2020 goals. We want to have strong profitability that converts, strong profits that are converted to cash flows so we can create value. This is a roadmap we're putting up here for our 2020 objective. You can see there that we want to be able to achieve up to $1 billion of positive cash flow as we get to the back end of our five-year plan. We'll do it by generating about $300 to $400 million of free cash flow by exiting the aerospace peak investment cycle and with the C-Series breaking even in 2020. So cash consumption and margins will hit that break-even point. We'll also deliver $500 to $600 million of cash from profit growth, and that's leveraging our top-line growth. So we talked about how we get to $25 billion, but also converting our lower cost structure into profit and then eventually into cash flows. By 2020, we could be producing up to $1 billion of free cash, sustainable flows. With that kind of long-term cash generation, we'd be in a position to deleverage our balance sheet, and we'd continue to drive and deliver strong shareholder value. I'd like to take a minute here, and I think it's the right spot to do it, to talk a little bit about liquidity, something that I think we've made tremendous progress in 2016. We created the air cover to execute our turnaround plan in 2016. We put in place deep liquidity by raising cash, and you're all aware of the transaction we've completed in 16, about $2.5 billion of cash raise. We've also refinanced our 2018 maturities, so we have no maturities until 2019, and those are all very manageable within our cash flows. And we've extended our credit facilities and our revolvers into 2019. So simply said, you know, we expect all the liquidity necessary to turn the business around to complete our execution plan. We'll finish this year with $3.5 billion of cash on hand and total liquidity of $4.5 billion. And as I said, no maturities until 2019. So with this, we have all of the measures needed to turn around the business, to complete our investments, and most importantly, to ensure that we have no distractions on execution over the next 3 to 4 years. So having taken you through the overall business, I'd like to just spend a couple of minutes and talk a little bit about the business units, but I'll leave most of the detail to the leadership team that's coming up behind me. 2017 performance at each business unit underlines the progress we're making in transforming the business and towards our 2018 and 2020 goals. Each segment will deliver strong margins while maintaining disciplined approach to production and working capital. And that's good for cash flow. And without going into the details, you'll see that we'll have mid-single digit growth across BT, BCA, and Aerostructures from a sales point of view. And margins are expected to be across the board 7.5% or more. BCA will benefit from learning curve efficiencies and will produce 4 to 5 times the volume that they did in 2016, and they'll do so with overall absolute lower net negative margins. So that's showing you the power of our learning curve already kicking in 2017. Maybe if I turn to the conclusion before I turn it over to Jim and talk a little bit about transformation. I think what comes out of this very clearly, and we say this with a lot of confidence, we're in full transformation. We've already seen the benefits of our actions in 2016. We are a growth business. Our investments in a broad product portfolio and our powerful in-service fleet across trains and planes drives our top line in the back end of this five-year plan as we go to 18, 19, and 20. When you combine that lower cost structure and that top line growth, we see powerful earnings acceleration ahead. We have a clear roadmap to sustainable cash flow generation that will create value for both equity and bondholder investors. So with that, I will turn it over to Jim.
Thank you, John, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Over the course of the next 30 minutes, my colleague Nico Buchholz and I will share with you the progress of our transformation plan. Let me first start by putting the transformation plan into context. Alain and John talked about a five-year turnaround at Bombardier that consisted basically of three phases: the de-risk phase, which is clearly behind us, the build phase, and the deliver. The operational transformation is a key pillar of the build phase and is delivering against and built into the five-year financial plan. Let me start first a little bit with what I said to you last year. Last year, as I stood before you, I had mentioned to you we'd created a transformation office at corporate underneath my leadership and satellite offices in each one of our four business segments. The teams had done a bottom-up initiative, and we had come up with a plan, and the plan was basically to deliver $2.5 to $3 billion of incremental cumulative free cash flow across the 5 years between the end of 2015 and 2020. And this is what we baked into our financial plan. I'm very happy to say that after the first year of our transformation, which arguably is kind of a transitional, challenging kind of year, our transformation teams and initiative owners have delivered. And they've delivered, I think, to a great extent. Year one, $700 million of free cash flow has been liberated from the transformation. If we take a look at the $700 million, it breaks down to two components. $500 million worth of free cash flow released against working capital, which is really driven by inventory initiatives. And $200 million of free cash flow driven by cost savings initiatives that have given us recurrent EBIT savings. And I'm very proud of that. $200 million of recurrent EBIT savings in the first year of a transformation and $500 million worth of working capital is a great start. If I focus a little bit on the EBIT side, so last year we mentioned we had basically three levers that we could attack as part of our operational transformation. The first lever was a direct cost lever. This is a bucket of about $14 billion on average of cost that is driven by what goes on to our products, what we buy from our vendors, and the value added we put in. We have a second lever, which we call indirect cost, which is basically a lever of about $4 billion annually, and this is the administrative costs of all the administrative functions in the company, SG&A type of functions, as well as the goods and services that we procure as a company. So if you look at our $200 million worth of EBIT, it really was driven basically two-thirds coming from the direct cost lever and one-third from the indirect cost lever. Now, we've aligned the company under six work streams against these cost levers that we've named them in very simple terms. So under direct cost, we have the cost levers of manufacturing efficiency, manufacturing footprint, and supplier BOM. And on the indirect cost side, we have the three levers of administrative efficiency, indirect goods and services, and our global workshare centers. So the entire company has aligned its EBIT cost reduction initiatives against the six work streams. So if I take our $200 million that we got this year and I look forward towards 2020, what do we see? First, we had mentioned that in 2020, the transformation was going to deliver about 300 basis points to the overall EBIT plan of the company. So about $750 million of 2020 EBIT is coming from our operational transformation. So if you look at it, the $200 million that we got this year gives us another $600-odd million of EBIT to go get in the next 4 years. About $400 to $500 million of that EBIT is currently in execution, and it's in execution against the four work streams that really impact the way we do work at Bombardier. That's our manufacturing efficiency, our administrative efficiency, our manufacturing footprint, and our global workshare centers. These four work streams are going to deliver another $400 to $500 million in the next few years. Nico will come up and talk to you in a few minutes about the other two work streams, our supplier BOM and our indirect goods and services that round us out to the over $750 million. Let me take a few minutes and let's dig a little deeper into this $400 to $500 million. Where is it coming from? As you guys know, in 2016, we announced two restructuring events. one in February, and one in October. This restructuring impacted over 14,000 positions in the company, and it was in direct support of these four work streams, really in direct support of restructuring the way we do work. These restructuring announcements total $500 to $600 million worth of savings by the end of 2018. Now, why do I say that we're in motion already? Because $100 million of the $500 to $600 million has already been delivered in 2016. So $100 million of the $200 million that we delivered in 2016 has been supported by this restructuring initiative. So we have another $400 to $500 million to go. Gives me a lot of confidence because our teams know how to do it. They've already started, and they're delivering results. This has a great impact on the company. First, if you look at the dotted line behind me on the graphic, what you see is basically the output per FTE going up between 2015 and 2020. To be expected, right? We're growing from $16 billion to over $20 billion, $25 billion as a company. You expect our output per FTE to go up. What the structural changes that we're doing is also having as an effect is it's taking the average cost per FTE during this time frame down by 5%. And that's really powerful, right? We're growing as a company, but our average cost per FTE is coming down during the same time frame. Now you may say, Jim, how are you guys doing this? How are you growing? One-to-one book-to-bill ratio at BT, the C-Series ramping up, the Global 7 coming in, innovation, and still taking your cost down. Well, what you have to understand is what our work streams discovered during our bottom-up analysis and the work we've done in 2016 is we had a lot of redundancy in the system at Bombardier. We had a lot of things being done in a lot of places that were very similar across the network. In fact, I've had the pleasure of visiting many of our plants across the last year that I've been on the job, and I tell you, I call many of them the jack-of-all-trade plants. We did everything from make a fastener all the way to assemble a final product. Clearly, not the most efficient way of doing things. So what are we talking about here? We're talking about site specialization. We're talking about creating centers of excellence where we take our best processes, surround it with our people, and give a site a global mandate to deliver that good or service around the globe. And it's this fundamental structural change that gives me a lot of confidence that A, we're going to get these financial results, and B, we're actually changing the way the company works. Perhaps let me give you two examples to help you understand this a little easier. I'll start with Belfast. Belfast was already a center of excellence for complex composites. It makes the most complex composite we have in the company, the C-Series wing. What are we doing at Belfast? We're building on the center of excellence, and we're basically making Belfast a center of excellence for aerostructure systems. Whether they're composite or metallic, it doesn't matter. Belfast will deliver to BBA and BCA complex aerostructure systems. The simple component parts, they go out to other facilities in that network that specialize on making component parts. This example at Belfast doesn't only apply to aerospace. We're also spreading across all of BT. And also, centers of excellence aren't limited to manufacturing. Laurent will come up in the next session. He'll talk to you about a centers of excellence that we're creating at BT around an administrative function, engineering. So at BT, we're creating centers of excellence where we're putting our engineers surrounded by cross-functional team in a location, and their mandate will be to deliver a specific product, for example, a locomotive or a double-decker. What this allows us to do is take bids coming in from around the globe, combine them with the basic fundamental building blocks of, let's say, a double-decker that we've already designed, merge the two together, give the customer a product that meets their requirements, but allows us on the internal side to gain the efficiency of our designs and on the manufacturing side to gain the efficiency of reproducing the fundamental building blocks over and over again. So I've covered with you guys the four work streams that are delivering against our EBIT goal for 2020, which is really all around restructuring the company. I'm going to pass the baton on to Nico now, who will talk to you about the other two work streams, the supplier BOM work stream and the indirect goods and services work stream. This is how we're working with our partners so they can bring value to our transformation.
Thanks, Jim.
Well, good morning also from my side. Looking at all the activities which we have been doing, I think you have seen in John's presentation and Jim's presentation, there's no single solution to everything. So it's a team approach which we have been embarking on. So let me look on the direct product cost. We have on that chart, you have aerospace and transportation. Let me focus on a couple of things in here. Like our target is we want to get more than 200 basis points out of that. For the direct product cost, just as a small reminder, that's about $14 billion. We have been working closely with all our vendors, and during the course of the year, we have delivered unit reductions, which provide even greater impact as we go along for the following years. And one of the things is also a book-to-bill ratio in BT, which is about 1.1. We talked about the C-Series ramp-up, which will have a significant impact. That's on the chart, is growing the new programs and leveraging scale. And we have the Global 7000 coming into production because flight test has started. In addition, one of the things which changed compared to the previous Bombardier is really we grouped all the procurement into one organization. So our ability to speak with one voice to all the suppliers actually does significantly allow us to negotiate win-win relationships when we leverage $14 billion of total spend rather of working as four small companies. On the aerospace side, we also have introduced key account leaders who are single Bombardier voices and contacts to our suppliers. So everything which happens with that supplier goes through one. You would say this is state of the art. It wasn't. We have introduced that. It's working. We have now established those. And we also can, with this, have a strategy with each of those suppliers. On the BT side, our business was fragmented. Like there was every village had the procurement team, had every system duplicated. Jim elaborated on that on the footprint side. Now we have one region, one supply base contract area. And if you look at the suppliers on the chart, it says 10,000. We're going down to 2,000 around in 2020, we have come last year from 30,000 suppliers. And this is really making our system more efficient. It creates more win-win. It brings our cost down. Our spend with the top 100 suppliers today was only, or last year, was 60%. We will grow that significantly in order to have, again, more efficiencies, more scale. If I look at, we're still on the right chart. We're consolidating the spend, therefore, with a smaller group of suppliers who are becoming our partners and therefore have more incentive also to work on win-win solutions with us. This is one of the things, because some of you asked me last year, how do you do it? You shrink some part of the business, and how do you want to get cost out? Well, we have found suppliers with whom we want to work. We are significantly pushing them up, and therefore they have a winning proposition for themselves as well. If I look at indirect goods and services spend, for many people, a black box is not a black box. Yes, it's $2 billion, but we know pretty well what it is. We have analyzed it. We leverage our global workshare sites to manage demand coming from all the entities. And this ensures a minimum leakage and it maximizes compliance. And consolidating the procurement teams, again, into one procurement team for aerospace and transportation, we have one global leader and we're able to negotiate true global contracts. Again, one of the things, leveraging scale. As an example of our efforts, just pick one, and it sprang into mind. It includes waste management, cleaning, landscaping, snow removal, etc.
If we just look at Montreal alone, we're at about 500 different suppliers. Leave alone just managing 500 suppliers, which takes a ton of people, it was not the most efficient way, and we probably employed everybody who would offer those services. Right now, we are consolidating that into one supplier who has some sub-suppliers. This is resulting in overall savings in a double-digit percentage area. This is just one example of how that consolidation actually helps. And remember, we came from a highly decentralized world. And that really means each region, each business unit, and the subunits managed their own indirect spend with no correlation to each other. Right now, we know we can have these actions, which I just described and you see on the chart, will help us to get at least 100 basis points down in terms of the cost or expand our margin. And that is just a short summary of what we are doing, in addition to everything which the business units do, what Jim is doing on the transformation. And with that, I think I'll pass back to Jim.
Thank you, Nico. So over the course of the last 15 minutes or so, Nico and I, we talked to you about basically the six work streams that are driving the EBIT portion of our cost reductions and our free cash flow. Allow me to talk to you over the next couple of minutes about the working capital side, because it's equally important. If you want to understand working capital at Bombardier, it's very simple. It's inventory plus accounts payable and accounts receivable, those three buckets. Together, those three buckets are around $13 billion on average per year. As we look at this complete working capital bucket, one thing clearly stood out to us. It's that the WIP, the work in process, the inventory that we have in our final assembly lines is 70% of the total working capital bucket. So guess where we started to attack? We started really to attack the WIP, the work in process in our final assembly lines, because this was the biggest opportunity we had. And I'm gonna illustrate what we're doing in a very simple example to make it clear. So if you look at the top of the graphic behind me, you just see a very simplified aircraft assembly line. You know, it consists of different stations, in this case, five stations. So the first station, you got the tail and the fuselage that come together. The operators do that. Then you move to the next station, you install the wings that you see in orange. Then you move to the next station, you install the engine, so on and so forth. That kind of gives you an inventory cycle following the gray curve. So as you add more value added to your finished product, your inventory goes up, right? Now, what did we learn? And we really drew upon centers of excellence that we have in Derby on the rail side and in Mirabel on our commercial aircraft side. We learned fundamentally three things that we're applying to our assembly lines going forward and retrofitting to the existing assembly lines. The first thing we learned is that when you get your engineers and your operations people to work together in designing a product, you actually could design a product that doesn't take as many steps to assemble. It comes together easier, so to say. So in this example, on the second line, marked revised, what you see is an elimination of one station. Obviously, if you eliminate one station, you kind of shorten the time your money's out there per unit on inventory. So you start building inventory following the blue line on the graphic. Second thing we learned is our engineers working together with our supply chain providers can also design major subsystems. In the case of a plane, we're talking about wings and engines, which are high-cost subsystems. They can be designed and tested to come into your assembly line later on, the so-called plug-and-play model. So you don't have to install them early in your assembly line. You can install them later. So that kind of shifts the profile of your inventory dollars. It shifts them closer to the point of delivery. And the third thing we learned is when our procurement teams work with our suppliers, explain our inventory build cycle, well, then we get into things like consignment, which has our suppliers supporting the inventory cycle, and payment terms, which has a working capital effect. Those three things, and the implementation of those three things against our assembly lines, is what liberated $500 million worth of free cash flow in 2016, and we're gonna continue to exercise this as we go forward. What's really important to understand is the end goal here is we're a growing company, right? We're growing from 16 to over $25 billion. And what we're trying to do is take down our inventory, manage it basically within a bucket of dollars that's pretty much equivalent to where we're going to be at the end of 2017. This will naturally give us about a half point lift in turns for the company as we go towards 2020. So in conclusion, our transformation is in full motion. All four of our business segments are delivering results. As I look forward to the next 2 years, it's really all about three simple things. Continuing our journey on our centers of excellence and completing it, making sure that Nico and the team continue to build the momentum on the supplier BOM side, and applying all the learnings on our work in process so we can liberate the free cash. And with that, I'll pass it over to Patrick, and I think we're ready for a Q&A period.
So we'll just take a couple of minutes to set up here for the Q&A. We're running, timing is very good, so we'll have a couple of extra minutes for questions. So we'll have Alain, John, Jim, and Nico on stage. So we'll ask you maybe for this session to really focus on the questions relating to strategy, finance, and all that. I think we shared a lot of information towards the good questions. And we'll keep these specific questions to the business unit leaders for the later session. So I guess on the webcast as well, you can submit your questions, so please do so. I'll ask you to raise your hand when you have a question. I'll point to you. There's a few microphones that will be going around. And on the web, I'll alternate between in the room and in the web. So if we're ready, I guess we'll go at our first question here.
Bill Mastores.
Try it again.
It's fine. It's
just
gonna try
it again. Believe me.
Bill Mastores with Baird and Company. So my question is for Alain and John. And Alain, one of the things you mentioned is, and John, you also reiterated this, that you have the right level of liquidity now, which would imply that you really don't need any additional investments from the federal government. Is that off the table? And if it's not off the table, where do you stand right now? And I do have a follow-up.
Well, we're still in discussion with the federal government. And as we said before, I mean, we're looking at adding flexibility to our financial position, more in terms of being able to manage unexpected risk, or in terms of thinking about what we do next in terms of launching the next platform. So that's where we are, still in discussion with them. But obviously, things have changed a lot over the past 12 months. So we're, the discussions are taking a different path.
Okay, and so my follow-up would be, John, you imply here through your slides that liquidity will probably bottom out at about $3.5 billion going forward. Are we going to see a lot of additional refinancings to go ahead and take care of the 2019 maturities? Is that how we should appropriately think about liquidity going forward, that any type of maturity that would come up is going to be refinanced, and that minimum liquidity level of $3.5 billion will always be maintained?
Yeah, I think what where you start that conversation is that what we're putting together is a business that will have strong access to markets. We were in the market just a short while ago, and I think from what we're doing here and as we get towards those 19 maturities, we'll have, again, very strong market access. And our intention, I think, at this point in time, we don't have to make that decision today, that's the first thing, right? But I'd say that our intention at this point in time is probably those early maturities, 19, 20, we'd look at refinancing, and at some point in time, look at how we would handle balance sheet deleveraging. But don't forget, we'll have strong EBITDA growth through this plan, and I think there's going to be a significant deleveraging impact that'll come just from the business growing into a larger its balance sheet. So there's a bit of both there. I'd say that for 19 at this point in time, assume refinancing. 20, similar. We don't have to make that decision today.
Okay, and that minimum level of $3.5 billion, is that a fair statement?
Yeah,
that
it's on the chart.
You're not going to drop below that?
Well, it's on the chart, right?
It's so, on the chart.
I've already said it. So.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Take the question from Walter in the back.
Yeah, thanks very much. Walter Spracklin with RBC Capital Markets. I guess maybe, John, when I look at your 2020 guidance for $3 billion in the C-Series on 90 to 120 aircraft, that gives you about $30 million per aircraft. You know, your list is somewhere between 72 and 82. 60% discount seems a little bit higher than I would have thought. You know, most of those are going to be, you know, full production aircraft. So am I getting something wrong with regards to that per unit aircraft revenue?
I'm not sure I fully got the question.
So $3 billion you have guided for 2020. Yeah, right over here.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, 2020 guidance is $3 billion for the C-Series program.
Yes.
On 90 to 120 aircraft.
Correct.
So $30 million roughly. On a list of 72 to 82, that's a 60% discount to list. Is that, am I missing something on that?
Yeah, go ahead.
I think that what you need to factor in here is like throughout the period up to 2020, I mean, we have like already sales done, okay? And obviously, you, as we've said, there was like some launch pricing on these aircraft, so that's part of what we're seeing. And then I would not draw the conclusion that you're getting to in terms of pricing per unit in 2020. And as you will perfectly understand, what is list price versus what is like commercial terms are different things, not only for us, but for everybody else in the industry. And we feel good about where we're on the new campaigns.
Okay, and just as a follow-up, you know, with regards to your EBITDA margin improvement this year, quite significant, but you've got a big chunk that is going into your restructuring. You know, pessimists might say that, you know, you're stripping out some of those costs and putting it into non-recurring restructuring. Perhaps if you give us a little bit more detail on what the restructuring charge is to show that it is kind of going toward recurring savings as opposed to just moving buckets around a little bit.
Well, I mean, it's I think we've announced a lot of that detail when we did the restructuring announcements on headcount over the last year, specifically the last one. The simple math is that the restructuring initiatives that we've launched will save between $500 and $600 million of expenses over a we'll grow into those over the next 24 months as we get to the back of end of 18, and that'll be a recurring savings from 19 forward at a level of $500 to $600 million. And if you look at the spend over the two announcements we've made, we're looking at 250 to 300 one year, 250 to 300 the other year. It's kind of a one for one, so we get a 1 year payback.
And you said about 100 to 150 for next year as well left to go in restructuring charges. Did I hear that?
For 17, yep. We said $300 million.
Yep.
And we'll spend, again, you know, early to say for now, but I mean roughly $150 million in 18 based on how we see the phasing of those restructuring initiatives coming out.
Okay, thank you.
Right, we have next question on the front here on the left.
Good morning. Thanks for taking my question. Deepak from GMP Securities. It's a question for Alain and John. So you've outlined, you've done a great job outlining where the growth is going to come from here to 2020. I had a question about the base business, the $16.5 billion that you're going to do this year. Can you talk about the risk to that base business? How much of that is perhaps services or recurring in nature? And how much of that is that risk that you have to win every year to get to your 2020 goal of $25 billion in revenue? Thank you.
Well, I'll kick that off if you want to add anything, Alain, by all means. But we have an aftermarket business, you know, roughly $3 billion. I mean, without breaking down the whole 16.5, you know, I think you mentioned about services, about $3 billion in the current context. We have a great fleet. That fleet continues to operate very well, both planes and trains. But, you know, when you look at the backlog at BT, very strong, solid backlog, continuously over 1-to-1 on an annual basis, very strong pipeline. The guys will talk about their respective prospects going forward. As you look at the base business, just a comment, you know, from how we look at it, we've come to a revenue low point in 16. We're showing $16.5 billion of revenue. Look at our 17 guidance. We've continued to be very disciplined in how we show the match of production to market. So from our perspective, we've actually done all the hard work in thinking about the base business already in the plan. And the growth is just on top of prudent, well-managed base business on both business aircraft, commercial aircraft. You can see that from our commercial guidance this year, we've taken down CRJ and Q a little bit. The business aircraft, we've shown that we're very much aligned to the market as we are today, and I don't think we're going to have further reduction from what we've guided.
Okay, thank you. And just to follow up, perhaps it's just a clarification on something you said earlier, Elaine. You mentioned placeholder in terms of new programs, and you kind of alluded to new potential new platforms in the future in the answers to one of the previous questions. Does your current cash flow spending plan for 2020 incorporate potential new programs, or do you have to look for external funding to achieve that?
So we have already baked in $1 billion a year moving forward in 19 and 20. The 7,000 will basically phase out at the end of 2018. So that's the reason why I'm starting to think about, you know, what we do next. Because, you know, I mean, it takes some time to do the planning of the next launch. We're working very closely with both, you know, Fred and David. We're looking at commercial. We're looking at the business aircraft side. But I think that we're well, you know, provided in our financial plan to launch the next platform. And again, it's all about confidence, you know, like adding additional cash to the business gives us additional confidence to launch the next platform earlier. But I feel that in our base plan, we're in a good position right now.
Okay, we'll take our next question in the back, and then we'll go online.
Yes, thank you. It's Bill Ledley from Cowen. I had a follow-up question on that development spend. As you look at your product portfolio today, where do you see the opportunities for incremental development? Is it mostly in the biz jet side? Is it more in the commercial side or transportation? If you could just give some more color as to how you think that development fits within your current product portfolio. And then I have a follow-up.
Well, you will hear from David and from Fred today what they are doing and what they're thinking and how we're positioned. I would say it's both. You know, it's both plus the train side. But the train, you will also hear from Laurent that we've got a lot of very, you know, new platforms where we've invested a lot of money over the past few years that we will be leveraging over the next 5 years. So too early right now to tell if we're going to decide to move towards business aircraft or commercial aircraft, but we see opportunities on both sides right now, and we want to make sure that it will be the best investment moving forward, and it will address a specific need or specific market opportunities, and our capital will be well invested with solid returns.
Okay, thanks. And then just a question for John. In the restructuring provisions, how much of a benefit do you expect from the German reorg in transportation?
I didn't get the last part from?
The German reorganization for transportation. Is there a big saving from that?
Yeah, that. Okay, you're saying the German...
the German.
...was announced this week. Laurent will comment on that.
Okay.
Maybe he's next up.
So. Great. All right, thank you.
Maybe we'll go to Fadi in a couple of minutes. I'll take just one question from online. So it's a question from John from Cornark at Macquarie. Does 2017 free cash flow guidance reflect the recent settlement with SkyWest? And how should we think about RVG liabilities?
So in terms of the recent announcement we made, I think we, you know, have come to a very positive arrangement with SkyWest in terms of some of the RVG liabilities that we had outgoing. You'll see that as we release the Q4 results. They'll take down a significant amount of our RVG liability, somewhere in the neighborhood of $250 million of obligations. We'll have settled that for about $90 million of cash. So very positive for us. We've got that planned in 16-17. We have some optionality about how and when we pay that. What I can tell you is that both 16 and 17 guidance today reflects how we intend to settle the cash on the $90 million. It's not an overly significant amount, of course. It's not a trivial amount, but at the end of the day, it's not going to move our guidance in any of those two periods. With respect to go forward, we do this annually, and we review it on a regular basis in terms of our provisioning levels. We have a lot of confidence in our read of the market. We did this early when we built the plan last year on the five-year plan, assessing how much we believe the cash outflows would be. I won't get specific, but you can imagine this is a bit, you know, of sensitive information to be putting out there, but you should just feel confident that we have, I'd say, a very realistic, good view of what our obligations will be. They're embedded in the five-year cash flows that we put up here on our five-year plan, and 2016-17 won't move because of the SkyWest. It's planned, so it's within those guidance ranges.
All right. Thanks, John. We'll go to Fadi there, and then in the back.
Sure, thank you.
Good morning.
Along the same kind of questioning before, I'm just wondering, you've laid out the plan for the commercial division to get to sort of a slight positive, I guess, EBIT by 2020. Is this the right product set that you have right now that gets you to a more normalized profitability down the road of high single digit, low double digit? Or do you envision having to make significant investment potentially in the regional sets or in the other products to sort of drive this profitability higher, given the increased competitive landscape in those kind of markets in the last few years?
Is your question, just to make sure I understand the question, is your question related specifically to commercial aircraft, or are you thinking of us investing somewhere else to increase the ROS?
No, specifically to the franchise, the commercial aircraft franchise.
Well, I think the commercial aircraft franchise right now, it's all about the C-Series. If you look at where we have invested massively over the past few years is in developing this amazing aircraft that's got like superior performance, and the airlines, and I will let Fred, you know, discuss this a little bit more, but airlines are now starting to recognize the full value of the platform. So that's really where the potential is, and we feel good about where we are today. A lot of people didn't think a year ago that we would be able to do everything that we've done in 16. I mean, the platform has, both platforms are certified. We are in service. Performance is very, very, very good. If you ask customers, you will see that they are very pleased with the early introduction of these aircraft in service. So moving forward, now Fred and the team are thinking about what else we need to do to keep growing the business. But I feel there's a lot of like untapped potential in commercial aircraft, and the bulk of it will come from the C-Series.
Okay, and back to the residual value guarantees. I'm just wondering if you can help us understand, in your disclosure, you have, I think, about $990 million of exposure over the next 5 years of residual value guarantees. And you've done this settlement with SkyWest. So how should we think about that $990 million relative to a cash outflow potentially over the next few years?
Yeah, like I said, you know, it becomes very difficult because then there's RVG holders, and I'm going to, you know, disclose what potential levels of settlements might be out there. But I would tell you that you look at the SkyWest arrangement. I'd say that was a favorable arrangement that we came to. And when you look at what we have on the balance sheet, we have about $600 million provisioned against our future liabilities. So in there, you can get a bit of an inference for the, you know, 600 on about, what is it, a $1.6 billion or so of exposure. We're adequately provided from a cash flow point of view with respect to RVGs. They're part of the five-year plan, and we'll take them one at a time as they become due. Those are case-by-case discussions, but this is not something that I think will be a large variant in our cash flow estimates.
Okay, thanks.
Good question in the back, and then we'll come in the front here.
Good morning. Good morning, and thank you very much for taking my question. Steve Trent from Citi. Just curious on your take when we think about maybe unexpected political events over the last year, whether it's Brexit or elections in the United States. You know, to what extent are you now thinking there's more variance in the very good growth numbers you guys are putting up versus what you may have been thinking at the beginning of this year? And on a related question, I'm also curious whether the U.S. President-elect's comments on NAFTA might at least be somewhat coloring your conversations with Ottawa.
So just to make sure again, you're talking about what could be the macroeconomic impact and political environment on our business, right? I think that we are in a good spot today, to be honest with you. I mean, if you look at Brexit, we do have operation in the UK. We have a very strong presence, and we are monitoring it. We're following this, but we have operation in Derby, and we have operation in Belfast, and we feel, you know, that we don't see a major or if any impact on these operations. It's the new leadership change in the U.S. We see that relatively positive. I mean, it's pro-growth, pro-business. We kind of like that. We have a very large presence in the U.S. We buy, you know, like more than 50% of our products in the U.S. through a very large supply chain. So, I mean, we're embedded into the U.S. fabric, to be honest with you. So, and collaboration between Canada and U.S. has always been very good, very, very strong. So, honestly, I mean, we're optimistic about this this leadership change, and we think it could be very good for our business, especially for the business aircraft segment.
Great, thank you.
Hi, Alain. It's David Terman from Cormar. I just wanted to follow up on your comment about good untapped potential at BCA and the bulk of it in the C-Series. So aside from stretching the aircraft, is there anything else you can do that would be large?
We keep asking, I mean, people keep asking the question. I mean, we are focused right now on making the 100 and 300 a huge success in the marketplace. And I will leave that up to Fred to talk later. I think that this is the right thing to do. It's the right strategy. And in time, we'll see what we do. But now it's not the time.
And maybe just a follow-up on the business transformation. So you're creating these centralized entities to make the business more efficient. The question I guess I have is I think about that and I think, well, geez, now you've got a bureaucracy where the guys in the plants have to go to the central place and get it. How do you make sure you don't end up making the organization slower through this process?
A good question. In fact, what we're doing is we're trying to reduce the bureaucracy because we're creating the centers of excellence at the plant. So if I take Belfast, the engineering for the structures coming from Belfast and the operations people are in Belfast. So wherever possible on the manufacturing side, we're merging the two and co-locating them in the same facility to eliminate that redundancy in the network. Because honestly, today we had quite a bit of that.
If anything, if I might add to Jim here, that's what we've done over the past like 12 to 18 months is to lean out the organization to make it more efficient, more agile. And we work extremely well as a team. Our corporate group is like very actively involved, working very closely with the business units and vice versa. I mean, our response time is excellent. So, I mean, we move fast. And actually, if there's anything is we're not adding bureaucracy, we're going exactly the other way around. I mean, we're leaning out the business. In wave one and wave two, I mean, we've announced a reduction of 15,000 people. I mean, that's on a 70,000 base. So, I mean, you can see that we're taking a very aggressive approach to taking costs out and adding the right resources with the right talent where it makes sense so that we can keep on driving the business for superior performance.
Good question on the left.
Yeah, just over here, guys. Sorry, it's Steve at Raymond James. Quick question on the supplier base. You've made some massive consolidation efforts here over the last year and a half, which seem to have generated some commendable savings. But this also comes at a time when you're preparing to ramp some key flagship programs. And so I'm just trying to understand the flexibility or the confidence you have in the supply chain to adjust so quickly as you consolidate that base. And where do you see the key risks that might still be lying? And as a derivative of that, is what is your confidence in the C-Series delivery schedule for next year?
I think when you look at it's a de-risking. First of all, look at the lead times. So do we touch when we simplify that supply base, when we really take structure out of it, it does not impact like the deliveries of today because we have a certain lead time for all those parts. And that is something which gives us the comfort that actually there won't be any disruption. Sorry, there won't be any disruption because we are working with the suppliers to consolidate that supply base. And some of those tier one, tier two suppliers will work with their sub-suppliers to actually create bigger systems so we actually can supplement what Jim has been saying on the production line to get faster and to reduce our working capital. But again, those savings, they're locked in. We are very well on our path. We have signed a lot of agreements this year, but they come into fruition really next year and the year after.
I guess I'm just struggling with the confidence you have in that. So it sounds like you're more confident now with a smaller supplier base, but at the same time, this is a very quick transition. And so you've got, you know, you've got big plans to ramp here in the very short term with some new sets of suppliers or a reduced set, but you're very confident they have the capability to provide those services?
Everything which we have changed so far has not had, well, we changed some things already this year, and they are implemented already this year, and they didn't have any impact on the production line, because one of the things we take real great care, because having come from the airline background, I know what it is if you get an aircraft actually later, or if something is disruptive in there. So we work very closely with all the respective business units when we do that, in order to actually avoid those disruptions. And knowing where those disruptions could be from the operator side and from the production side actually helped us to streamline those supplier choices.
Okay, helpful. And then just confidence in the C-Series delivery.
There's tons of confidence, I think, across, because otherwise, I think all the business unit presidents wouldn't be comfortable in delivering. It's, as said earlier, we are, as a management team, permanently discussing amongst ourselves what can we do, what is possible to implement. It's not just a desk exercise, which is being done, okay, I can save this much. What does it do to production? What does it do to sales? What does it do to customer support? We'll go all across the value chain in order to make sure that there's zero impact. Because our customers are our revenue, so that's not impacted. Right. There's no choice.
Okay, helpful. Thanks.
Just in the interest of time, we'll take, for this Q&A session, one more question from the room. We'll go with Benoit, one from the web. And we'll have another Q&A session after the 4BU presents. All speakers will be available. So a couple more questions, Benoit here, and then from the web.
Thank you. Benoit Poirier from Desjardins. Just looking at your five-year plan, I was wondering if there's any potential divestitures, either in terms of technologies, products, business segment, that could be divested over the next 5 years, and that would create some value creation for shareholders and provide you additional liquidities.
Well, we like the portfolio that we have today. I mean, we have four very strong businesses, and we're making them better, you know, every day. So we're not thinking about divesting. We're thinking about growing. We have invested massively in developing these new platforms. We have a very solid organization in place, technically and commercially. And the name of the game right now is to grow. And it's grow top line and grow earnings and generate better free cash flow. So very focused. You know, the same way we were focused on the first phase of de-risking the business, we've done it. Now that we've got that done, I mean, I'm very pleased with the businesses that we have, and you will hear more from them later, so you'll be able to judge for yourself, but you'll say, I think that, I mean, we're at a very good place right now.
Okay, and just a follow-up question. When we look at the booking, you mentioned a book-to-bill over one for transportation next year. I'm just wondering what type of assumption are you expecting on the business jet side and also commercial? I mean, I expect Fred and David to provide more color, but just in terms of assumption, the implication on a financial standpoint from a cash deposit, customer advance, and what could be the potential impact on the free cash flow depending or on your booking assumptions?
Well, I'll let the guys talk because that's, you know, I mean, that's what they'll handle. But I'll just tell you that when you look at the numbers I provided earlier, if you aggregate everything, you're looking at about $450 million of working capital positive generation, right? You have the programs generating $300 million, the remaining business is generating $150 million. And so that would give you a sense that we're fairly well aligned with the market. I think that it's too early now to start predicting what might come in the back end of 17 in terms of a market. It would be nice to see some kind of a lift in terms of just activity maybe in business aircraft, but we're not counting on any kind of, and I said it I think in my commentary as well, we're not counting on any kind of a market rebound or upswing to deliver our plans.
Thank you.
So just before we break, a question from Turan Katawala at Scotiabank, a question for Jim. You're working hard to take costs out of the system here with cost per FTE being going down. I assume you'd have done so some benchmarking versus your competition. So how does your 2020 goal on cost structure compare with your competitors?
Great question, Turan. So if we look at our plan, right, our operational transformation is geared to make Bombardier basically an 8% return ROS company. So it's solid kind of middle of the pack company, and our benchmarking and the work we're doing around going to our centers of excellence is really completely in line with that. I think once we get to our center of excellence, I'm positive then our centers of excellence through continuous improvement will continue past 2020, driving more benefits to the bottom line. But right now, the big focus is to get to that 2018 number, which drives us basically to about an 8% return company.
All right, thank you. So I guess we'll take a small 20-minute break. We'll come back. A lot of content still with our BU president, so back in 20.
Thank you. Okay, good morning, everybody. Oops, sorry. So thank you for coming to New York. Maybe you don't know me, but I've been on the job for 1 year. I have 25-year experience in rail. It has been a passionate journey. I've done many jobs in this industry, almost all jobs, and I'm still passionate about it, so I hope that I can bring some passion to you today. It's a fantastic business. There is a lot of opportunities. Some of our plants are more than 175 years old, and I think we will be there in 175 years. So we are, in fact, between tradition and modernity. So today I want to talk to you about who we are in Bombardier Transportation, and it's all about moving people. And we are moving people in the cities, and we are also moving people between cities. And we are today impacting every day millions of passengers everywhere on the planet. So of course it's a very high commitment, and what I can tell you is the value we provide to cities and to communities is very easy to measure. It is when it does not work. And I can give you the example of last week in Paris and London. There was a significant issue with a pollution peak. I don't know if you heard about that. It has been a very, very hectic moment in Paris and London. The level of CO2 emission was very high. The quality of the air was very poor. There was a lot of emergency in the hospital. And at that moment, you realize that you need public transportation working. The second example is the millions of commuters that are using trains every day. And the level, the single disruption in a commuting system brings, of course, a lot of chaos in any city. So it's all about moving people, and we do that today with a significant installed base. We have more than 100,000 cars in services all across the globe. And we are present in more than 60 countries. And we have more than 500 customers in 70 countries. And we are present in more than 200 cities. So we are a very global player all across the globe. And we are today very well placed to continue the development of public transportation all across the world. And who we are providing the highest value to our customer when they invest in rail infrastructure. And we help them to ensure the highest return on their investment. So this year, we have launched a significant transformation program. And I can tell you that the first year, we are on track with our program. And in 2016, we will deliver as per our commitment. And we have focused on de-risking our backlog and improving the quality of our execution. We have also revisited our complete value chain proposal and how we deal with our customers. As you can see, we have improved by 100 base points the financial profitability. I have implemented a leaner organization in BT with a new talents that have joined the team. And I have also significantly reinforced our leadership and the level of accountability. This year has been a very, very intensive year. And I'm very, very proud to lead the team and to bring BT to a new leading position tomorrow. As you can see, we have a profitable growth plan, and we want to reach a 10 billion business in 2020. And I am convinced that all the main trains are here to achieve that. And at the same time, we want to deliver the highest level of return on sales, above 8% at the end of the period. What is very important is that the visibility we have, thanks to our 31 billion backlog, is helping us to manage the transformation and to significantly improve the overall financial performance. So when you look to the market, this market is a very, very, very dynamic market. And you can see in every geographies, but also in every areas of the business, we can see growth. And this growth is on top of that very resilient to a crisis. In 2008, our industry faced no significant downturn because, in fact, most of the politicians on the planet realized that investing in infrastructure projects, and in particular public transportation, is good for their economy. And we can see that we have, since now some years and looking forward, a steady growth in front of us. And this growth is supported by three major trends. The first one is, of course, urbanization and environmental requirements. I mentioned the example of London and Paris last week, but I can tell you this is true in Asia, in Africa, in South America. It has been the case in Europe, in America, but it's just increasing. And when you look only at the mega cities, the cities above 10 billion people, today we have 29 of them and we expect to have 41 in 15 years. And Bombardier is already present and dealing with those cities in 66% of them. So 2/3 of the mega city on the planet, we are a key strategic partner of the city to move millions of people. And we are present in New York, we are present in Shanghai, in Beijing, in Singapore, in Paris. And this trend is just accelerating. And you can feel it when you look at the urbanization rate that you can see all over the planet. The second trend is there is a need to accelerate the delivery of new transportation systems. And there is a need to bring, as fast as possible, turnkey solution to the market that will significantly deliver the capacity that is being required and the reliability in service. And when I look to the investment that is being prepared by the city planning, everywhere there is a significant increase of kilometer of tracks and number of trains that is being planned everywhere. And it's not specific of one place or the other. This is really all across the globe. Additionally, to support that, there is a significant availability of cash to be injected in infrastructure projects. So there is a good combination between the need and also the financial support. The third one is traveling in trains is becoming more and more enjoyable. And thanks to the digitalization of our environment, we can provide today now an A to Z journey to travelers and them being always connected. So the feeling you have when you travel by train is unique. There is very few disruption, and at the same time, you are always connected. Additionally, the digitalization enables us to make your journey seamless. From home to office, you can enjoy a very easy trip, avoiding congestion, avoiding wasting time, and avoiding sometimes also pollution. So we provide very, very, very good traveling experience to many, many, many passengers. So all those three trends today are really accelerating the momentum in rail. And this is why we are convinced that this environment is favorable for a business growth. Our plan, in fact, is to outperform the growth. So as you saw, the growth is about 3%. And we are looking for a 5% growth till 2020. And we want to grow in all area, and I will explain you in how we are going to do that. But we have grown in the past, and we will continue to lead the growth in this rail industry. And we have all the key basic fundamentals ready to, in fact, deliver this growth. So the first element is that we have a unique platform of product. We are covering all the market segments wherever you are in the development of the city or the development of the region or a country. So we provide the best service in light rail, and we are the number one in the world in light rail, and we have a unique experience started in Europe 100 years ago. And light rail is the simple solution when you start to develop a city. And today what we can see is that many, many cities are starting to invest even more in this light rail vehicle because they provide the right capacity at the right cost. The second element, the second platform is our metro. And we are present in most of the cities I mentioned before. And we are delivering every day high capacity, high reliability in services, and also a very high punctuality. All the key parameters that are today the main element of differentiation when we deliver a complete metro. And we have a Movia platform today that is really well accepted by our customers everywhere, as I mentioned to you, in the mega cities, but also in the large cities. We are also present in the regional and commuter. So the regional and commuter is the type of train you need when you have a sprawling suburb. So your city is getting bigger and bigger, and you need to get out of the city, and you need then after to reach, of course, your suburb. And then, of course, you need to connect around a mega city, you need to connect other cities, and you go regional. And this business, of course, is start to grow significantly. It was very well developed in Europe, and now we can see that it starts to appear more in North America, but also in Asia, and in particular in China. And we are today the number one in this field, and we have two platforms that we want to leverage on to continue to serve the commuter and regional market. The first one is intercity and high speed, up to very high speed. And we have here a Zefiro platform that has been delivered in many, many countries. We are very present in China. We are the largest non-Chinese manufacturer in China with 6,000 people. We are present in most of the high-speed trains in Europe. And this train is the one unique experience you can have when you take this train. And if one day you can enjoy a travel in Italy, this is the Freccia Rossa, from Milano to Roma to Napoli, this is one of the unique experiences to travel high speed and to reach, in fact, from Milano to Roma in less than 2 hours, and you just sit into your business class and you will just enjoy the ride of your life. And if you can book a ticket, do not hesitate. Do not hesitate, this is a unique experience. You can have also a ristretto during the trip, and then after it, you go to paradise. So then we have our electric locomotive because we are also moving goods. And when we are moving goods, in fact today in Europe, the main element of freight is about cross-border application. And we are providing today the best-in-class locomotive to move goods. We have more than 1,800 locomotives, 80% of the market. It's a fantastic machine. And moving goods in Europe in particular with electric locomotive is a very, very important challenge when you look at the number of parcels that we need to move in the next 5 years. So all in all, I would say that we have invested significantly in superior platform that cover all the segments where the needs are here. So we need to position them to the market, but of course the level of development there is of course less than it used to be in the past. Who we are not only a rolling stock supplier, a product supplier, and we are in fact delivering complete solution. And in fact, a solution is a combination of many building blocks. The first one is infrastructure. The second one is, of course, the rolling stock. And we are providing also some other block, such as the signaling, the system integration, where you integrate all the blocks together, and also the services for operation and maintenance. And as far as we are concerned, we can enter the market through the rolling stock, but we are providing a lot of services that enable the customers to integrate, but also to operate and maintain. And we bring here a significant differentiation that enable our customers to have a better utilization of their rolling stock and their infrastructure. And we see here a significant opportunity to grow. And this is very true in the services, but this is also very true into the signaling and system integration. And why is it so? Because the signaling and system integration brings you the automation, and the automation is an enabler for you to reduce your operating cost. And in fact, the services is also an opportunity for you to reduce your maintenance cost. So the combination of the two, you reduce significantly the operation and maintenance cost, and you provide a better return on your investment. So today, not only we are capable to bring the best product that enables the best depreciation on the capital cost, but we are providing also the best operation and maintenance cost, which in fact, who we are an accelerator of the customer investment in their infrastructure. And this is a key position there, and this is how we are being perceived as a value creator to our customer. So we have launched, in fact, a transformation in order to move from the 6.5 this year. This is above last year by 100 basis points. And we want to go above the 8%. And I know that it has been said, but here I want to insist on the three fundamental differences of our plan compared to previous plan. And they are, it's about the revenue conversion and mix. The second is about the product and services platform. And the third one is about our operational and structural cost. And I want to explain to you the three fundamental changes that we are bringing into Bombardier Transportation in order to reach the 2020 target. So the first is about the revenue conversion and mix. And what is very different is our positioning in the ecosystem. And here I want to give you the example of New York, where we are today. And in New York, Bombardier, we are in fact delivering already different type of services. So we are one of the main players into the metro. So when you take the metro, there is a good chance that you take a Bombardier car. But we're also providing the service between JFK and New York on a driverless train. And so if you go to JFK by train, this is our train. But we're also providing commuter services to move from New York to the outskirts and into the suburb. And so we are uniquely positioned to provide higher and higher services to New York City. And we are the long-term strategic partner in this ecosystem. And of course, the major change for us is how we can continuously develop through our position, our business relationship with the people in New York, and in fact, to answer and meet the growing demands for public transportation. And it grows all along the value chain, not only with the rolling stock, but also with the signaling and the system integration, and also with the services. The second element is about the mobility solution. Our customers are realizing that our products are getting very sophisticated. And of course, they need to ensure that they have the best usage of their investment when they provide the transportation. And they are no longer looking for a train. They are looking for a solution. And when they express their needs is now being expressed in a different way. And they are speaking about capacity, which is how many people you transport per hour and per direction. They are speaking about punctuality. They are speaking about experience during your travel. They are speaking about connectivity. So the way they express their need is changing, and it's changing very, very fast. And who we are in Bombardier, we have this unique capability to understand the need and to translate this lead into a solution. And the solution is not only a train, but it's a complete package that enable our customers to significantly improve their performance in services. The third change is our partnering approach. And Bombardier is one of the unique company that develop very strong business relationship. And we are partnering with many, many key players in the ecosystem. And we are partnering with customers. We have been one of the first company in the world to develop joint venture to deliver services. And we have done that in Shanghai. We are doing that in Europe. And it is a very, very successful setup with our customer. We are also partnering with O&M. So we have announced partnering recently with the Chinese, but we are also partnering with Alstom in France or with Siemens in Germany. And we are also partnering with our suppliers that are becoming partners, as Nico said, because we want them to take a higher role in the value chain. And of course, partnering brought into the ecosystem give us a very strong competitive position. So all this should enable us to bring Bombardier Transportation to the 10 billion business. The demand is there, and those three blocks enable us, in fact, to serve on the wave and to match the growth and to exceed the growth. The second element is we are changing the way we design product. We used to be project-driven organization with a very significant level of customization. And when you customize, you take a lot of risk, and you bring the risk in the project execution, and you suffer, at the end of the day, very challenging moment when you are a bit delayed. So here we are reversing the approach. And because of the platform we have developed, I showed you that we have developed five platforms. The objective for us is to generate the product of tomorrow out of the platform we have, and then to customize this product just for what is necessary to our customer. And our objective is to significantly increase the level of reusability in the company. And this year, we have reached already 70%. And the target I fixed to the organization is a 70% reuse in our project, which should not only de-risk, but also accelerate the time to market, and then, of course, generate more cash and more profitability to the company. But at the same time you develop your platform, you capture in the platform your services business. So you embed in the definition of the platform all the key elements that will enable you to develop your services. And it could be about spare parts, it could be about repair and overhaul, it could be about fleet management. And by this approach, we intend to not only reduce our cost, but also to improve our profit. The third element of the transformation, as Alain said, is to significantly reduce our cost. And so we have launched this year the program to rationalize our footprint. And in fact, we have three major streams in this transformation. The first one is about engineering. And we want to create center of excellence to develop our product out of our platform. And we want to reduce that to 10. We used to be 60. So down to 10 is a significant change. We have started this year. And of course, the development of our platform approach will enable us to reduce the number of center of excellence of engineering. The second element, this is our industrial footprint, where we want to develop industrial lead sites and to implement lean factories. It's a significant rationalization of our manufacturing footprint. And here we want to bring in our plant best-in-class Industry 4.0 practices for us to remain the leader in manufacturing. And the third one is about our global work share that we are developing in relationship with Bombardier, which is how you optimize all the different back offices functions and SG&A so that we reduce our total cost. At the same time, we need to bring new people in the organization in order to move from this previous local site-centric organization to more global expertise that we need to have in the company. So all in all, what I can say is Bombardier Transportation is a trusted partner of the cities and the countries to move people. And here I want to insist on one thing. Moving people is not something that is not important. This is a fundamental element of the development growth. And moving people is at the heart of designing and modernizing cities. And you are no longer a supplier of train. You are the partner of the cities. All the trends are today altogether coming to enable the change into a very modern world where we move people in a safe way, in a punctual way, and in a comfortable way. So I'm very convinced that we have all the key building blocks ready to overachieve the market growth. So I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Laurent. We'll now start with Jean Séguin, the president of their Aerostructures and Engineering Services division.
Okay, good morning, everyone. I'm Jean Séguin, president of Bombardier Aerostructure and Engineering Services. Today, I will highlight how we're leading the way, delivering on our plan and driving competitiveness through state-of-the-art technologies and amazing capabilities. So last year, we introduced you to Bombardier Aerostructure and Engineering Services. It's a business within Bombardier with incredible capabilities, and it has a proven track record of innovation in design and manufacturing. We presented some aggressive targets as we pledge a strong commitment to the transformation. And as you're going to see here today, we are delivering on our commitments. As with the rest of the business, we have developed robust transformation initiative across our foresight as we begin to rebuild the business. We've also created the condition and the culture to meet our targets for 2020. And we, with all of this, basically, we ensure that we're going to be the most advanced and competitive aerostructure manufacturer in the world. The execution of our 2016 transformation plan has driven our operational performance up and our entire cost base down. In 2016, we have achieved 100% of our working capital transformation saving targets, and we're also on track to meet our EBIT saving target as well. And we continue to leverage our amazing capability worldwide so that we can maximize on the expertise and the value proposition of our global footprint, which is going to lead significant recurring saving. 2016 also has been a busy year from a product development standpoint with major achievements. On the Global 7000, we've delivered cockpits, refuselage, horizontal stabilizers, electrical harnesses for the first four flight test vehicle. With one of our major external customer, Irkut, on the MC-21 program, we've delivered the nacelle also for their flight test vehicle. And on the C-Series, very busy about delivering cockpit, wings, half fuselage to support the ramp up in Mirabel. So this year, I think we've needed to focus on creating the condition to execute on our plan, basically evaluating our manufacturing footprint, analyzing our capability, and starting the wheel in motion with our employees and with our supply chain to fully deploy the transformation. A plan which has started to yield not only cost saving, but a culture of competitiveness improvements throughout the organization. Revenue growth is still forecasted to reach 2.5 billion in 2020, as we presented here last year. And we also remain on track for 2020 to meet in the guidance of 9 to 11%. In 2017, so next year, sales will grow by approximately 100 million over what they are this year. And through the transformation projects that we've put in place in 2016, we're now confident that we will increase our EBIT from 5.8% in 15 to 8% this year, and will reach over 8.5% in 2017. So our employees have been working really hard at executing the transformation. Their commitment reinforces our 2020 strategic roadmap and propel the business to the next phase, the next key phase rebuild. So we are a world-class aerostructure and engineering business offering over 100 years of experience in the design and manufacture of complex structure. From the conception and design phase through testing and certification to the highest quality manufacturing and finally first-class aftermarket support. We have provided major structure for every Bombardier aircraft program since 1987. And using a multidisciplinary approach, we are a partner in technology development to our business and commercial aircraft businesses. And we continue to set the standard for new technology, both in the product we produce and the manufacturing technique that we apply. The C-Series composite wing is arguably a key contributor to the amazing competitive advantage this aircraft platform provides. So this wing incorporates cutting-edge composite technology, which was developed in our Belfast facility. We've used our patented resin transfer infusion process to build complex components of the wing, the panels and the spars. And we've taken the learning that from the C-Series development of the wing, and we're using the same technology on the Global 7000 horizontal stabilizer with amazing results. The Global 7000 horizontal stabilizer is 15% lighter and gives a 20 to 30% cost saving over its predecessor. So the learning that we've took from the C-Series and leveraging it on the Global 7000, therefore we've de-risked that program, the testing that we're doing in the certification program. The aft fuselage of the C-Series is produced in our Saint-Laurent facility in Montreal, where we use the most advanced robotic technology. So in both the wing, the aft fuselage, and the cockpit, we deliver a fully integrated structure. This means that all the system, the wiring, are installed and tested, and as they're delivered to the final line in Mirabel, on time and at the highest quality standard. So when it arrives there, its integration to the final assembly is simplified, therefore reducing their cycle time. It contributes to the success of the C-Series program, its ramp up for full production. This is one of the ways that we reduce our working capital, as Jim shown earlier. Our structure accounts for approximately 25% of the C-Series aircraft, 15% of the Global 7000. And by 2020, our external revenue will represent about 20% of our total revenue, the balance being inter-segment revenues. We also have over 40 years of experience in the design, development, manufacturing, and aftermarket support of advanced technology engine nacelles. So as engine technology progresses, so too must nacelle technology. And we continue to be at the forefront of that business as well. So as I said earlier, most recently, we delivered the first fully integrated nacelle for the new Irkut MC-21 aircraft. It's a program we're very proud to be on. And we've basically, by being involved, it allows us also to continue to develop our expertise and refine our product offering in this area. Others of nacelle customers include Rolls-Royce, GE, Airbus, AEI, and Pratt & Whitney. Last year, I told you that the certification authorities, when they came to Belfast, remarked that we had set the benchmark for the certification of a composite wing. Well, this year, one of these authorities, as they're seeking to refresh their certification processes and standards, they've come to us to support their studies. When the same authorities reviewed our advanced fiber placement composite processes in Saint-Laurent, they remarked how impressed they were with our multidisciplinary approach, whereby the design integrates characteristics of the manufacturing processes. Quite simply, one of the senior leaders said, "It's one of the best pieces of engineering I've seen." So I can't think of a better endorsement. So revenue growth over the next 5 years is driven by clearly identified programs, including the Global 7000, C-Series, MC-21, and aftermarket. So this growth is not dependent on market recovery, but rather supported by our backlog. Our growth is supported by new program ramp-up as C-Series continues its successful entry into service and as the Global 7000 progresses to the test program. But our aftermarket business is also a key contributor to our revenue growth. So today, we support almost 2,000 aircraft in the aftermarket, both as a complement to Bombardier business aircraft and Bombardier commercial aircraft customer support network. But we also provide world-class aftermarket support to third parties, including other major OEMs, and also directly to airlines. We offer a broad portfolio of component services on engine nacelle, thrust reversers, flight controls, landing gear, electrical wiring, and also aerostructure. We continue to expand our offering by positioning ourselves to be a first choice repair and overhaul center to support the Bombardier SmartMart program and to develop also capabilities to provide missionized aircraft solutions for Bombardier platform and also adding capabilities in landing gear, hydraulics, structural repair solutions for Bombardier and third party aircraft. So our plan is to grow 10% per year, which is slightly more than double the market rate. We have been driving our cost reduction plan in three key areas, as we outlined last year. We've developed a robust industrial strategy, which is focused on creating centers of excellence in each of our international facilities. And now we're basically deploying this strategy. So we're maximizing the use of our global footprint by allocating production packages to the site that are most suited for different type of work based on their expertise and their value proposition. So we're seeing great successes in each of our specialized facility. I mentioned before that we're creating a competitiveness culture throughout the transformation. And one of the areas where it's really evident is in some of the value engineering projects that we've undertaken under the procurement efficiency. Of course, no, we're still using the typical approach to negotiate with our suppliers to reduce bill of material costs. But let's give you some example of what I mean by value engineering. Today, we have focus team within our manufacturing, engineering, and procurement groups, and they're working with the suppliers, and they're evaluating what the suppliers do with the suppliers to identify potential saving in the way the parts themselves are being produced. With one supplier, our team have proposed a plan to increase the number of parts that would be produced from a sheet of titanium without increasing the amount of material, meaning that we now get 25% increase in part count per the sheet. So just this project alone has saved us over $500,000 a year. And this is just one of hundreds of projects that we've identified to improve our procurement efficiency. Another example is on the C-Series fuselage. So in the initial design, many of the components were in titanium. However, by refining our studies, our analysis, our testing, we were able to revert back to aluminum, which provide great cost saving. So not only are we improving our bottom line, but we're also developing a competitiveness culture within our supply chain, creating competition where there wasn't any before, challenging our suppliers to be our partner in our journey to competitiveness. We see a potential of 15% saving by 2020 in this area. Finally, reducing costs through labor efficiency. It's about challenging our level of productivity in order to improve year after year. It's also about applying continuous improvement processes, about applying lean manufacturing principles in using our Achieving Excellence system. Through all of these initiatives, we will achieve 3 to 4% saving per year. So with these three areas of focus in place, we will achieve approximately $100 million of recurring saving by 2020, and we're confident with this that we'll deliver on the 9 to 11% EBIT margin by 2020. Last year, when I came here with an ambitious five-year plan to grow revenues substantially, to increase margin on all of the program, to certify and prepare production ramp-up on the new program, So you now know that we've delivered on the first year of this five-year journey. 2016 was a great year of achievements. And now that the transformation plan is well underway as we're rebuilding our business, our future looks bright as we rely on amazing capabilities, state-of-the-art technologies, world-class people and mindset, and a proven track record. So our confidence level is even higher on delivering this plan, and Bombardier Aerostructure and Engineering Services is leading the way by continuing to create competitive advantage through amazing Tier 1 capabilities. So thank you for your attention, and with this, I'll hand it over to David Coleal to talk about business aircraft. So David.
Thank you, Jean. Good morning, everybody. It's great to see you back a year later and a lot of familiar faces. So I like to pace, so I'm going to walk around the stage as I talk. So as Alain mentioned, he had three key themes, and we've carried those themes within to business aircraft. Last year, we talked about resetting our business, aligning to the production rates of the market, which we did. We put in place a formal cost reduction effort, which we are now executing, and you'll see we have a strong growth plan. So as we talk about 2016, very pleased of how we're doing. We have a world-class franchise, and we've optimized our business to align to the markets both on headcount, production rates, and our cost structure. Last year, we did talk about enhancing our business models, which took the form of going direct to our customers through the reduction of agents, as well as our pre-owned business model. And I'm very pleased with how the pre-owned team has been performing. We are at record level lows, inventory levels within our pre-owned facility, and the team continues to drive good financial performance per the requirements of pre-owned aircraft. We continue to drive margin expansion through our focused cost reduction efforts and our transformation. And as we committed to both our customers and the industry, we said we're going to fly the Global 7000 this year, and we did on November 4th. So we're very pleased. So as John and Elaine mentioned, we're on track for our 2020 plan as well as our 2016 guidance. So for 2017, what you see is on modest revenue reductions, we're going to continue to drive margin expansion. On the unit deliveries, what you're seeing there is the full run rate effect of the decisive action we took both in 2015 and the fine tuning we did in 16 and to be at 135 units. Now, what I'll say is I feel very confident that that's the right production levels for next year, but if the market picks up, we're poised well to be able to capture higher unit delivery next year if the market says it and it warrants it. And for 2020, I'll show you a clear path for how we get to $10 billion and do it profitably. I get a lot of questions about the market, and I also look to a lot of you smart people out there to kind of reaffirm, but every year we give a market forecast at eBase. And what you saw there, and this is an excerpt of it, is that we feel, again, we're very well poised for completing the year 2016. In 2017, we expect to be similar and flat conditions, but we are optimistic about the future 2018 through 2020. What we expect is the stable world economies are going to grow, and the emerging economies are going to recover. Wealth creation, meaning the GDP over 3%, clearly facilitates additional growth in the industry. For new programs, you're going to see multiple new programs hit the market in 2018 through 2020. That creates renewed interest in the market as well as new buyers. The Global 7000 will be one of those new entrants into the market. And as I mentioned, we took decisive action to align with the market production. All the other OEMs have followed suit subsequently, and what you're going to see is any additional inventory in the market will be absorbed, and we expect to see pre-owned levels and residual values for all kind of normalize through this coming time. And as the market grows, there's just a greater need for lift. So what you're going to see is the fleet operators and charter operators improve their number of flight hours. And the one strategic advantage we have is we are embedded with the four world-class fleet operators. We service them all and provide our products to them all. So what you can see is that basically, through the inclusive of 2016 through 2020, we expect there to be a potential of 3,300 aircraft that are available for delivery. Now for Bombardier, we have the industry's leading portfolio and feel we're very well positioned for this growth, whether it's in the light jet segment through our strong performance and in industry-leading Challenger series aircraft, as well as the 5-6000 and the segment-defining 7000. We have the industry's strongest backlog with an increasing gross book-to-bill approaching one, and we're going to continue to make sure we grow through our transformation efforts. So very excited about our portfolio, and like I said, if the market starts to grow, we're well positioned for that growth. Now, our growth plan is incumbent upon three key factors, and they're very logical in the approach. our current portfolio. As the market grows, we'll increase rate to make sure we maintain share profitably. Aftermarket, as John and Elaine mentioned, we have 4,700 aircraft in the fleet. We add well over 100 planes annually. So by 2020, we'll have well over 5,000 aircraft in our installed base. The mission there is we're going to make sure that for every delivery, we retain them in our service network, and we recapture more of the aircraft that are out in the fleet. And then, as we also mentioned, the Global 7000 will add an incremental $3 billion to our top line. So a very clear, robust plan for growth to 2020. But we're going to do this profitably. We're going to make sure that we're focused on our base of 6% this year. We're going to make sure we're focused on our transformation efforts to drive costs out of our system. We're going to convert the revenue of the 7,000-8,000 into EBIT margin and make sure that the growth that we get from the revenue of aftermarket is also converted at high margin contribution. So in our mind, we have a clear path to an 8-10% business by 2020. Our transformation, as Jim mentioned, focuses across a couple different items. Working capital. Our teams in our factory have done a fantastic job reducing cycle time through the system to means we can produce planes faster and we have a better turnover of working capital. We're also very focused on unit cost in the form of bill of materials, optimizing our direct indirect SG&A ratios, and in everything that's non-flyaway we look at making sure that we're consuming the right amounts at the best cost. So a very focused effort on our transformation. Service is exciting. We are the only one to have this many installed aircraft out in the network, and again, approaching over 5,000 by 2020. So what we're going to do is make sure we have a strong presence around the world. We opened a brand new center south of London called Beacon Hill. Beautiful, world-class facility. Very active right now. Customers flying in even before it opened. We're going to expand our Tucson, which has tremendous capability in both avionics, paint, and interior refurbs, and expanded plans for Fort Lauderdale. This is the entryway from South America and Europe into the US. So we're gonna make sure that we are present worldwide with our wholly owned subsidiaries. And the one thing we can do as an OEM that's different from a lot of the folks that service aircraft is we own the intellectual capital and the engineering. So I can provide products and services to our wholly owned subsidiaries that our competition can't, such as Ka band, which is, you know, internet connectivity. So we're gonna make sure we do that and use our capability internally to make sure that we provide products and services that the competition can't. And then the segment defining 7,000. Very excited about this aircraft. There is no competitive response to the Global 7-8000 at this point in time, largely because it's a point design. Four zone cabin designed from the inside out. It's got the most advanced technology in the cockpit and fly-by-wire capability and legendary performance that Bombardier is known for. Smooth ride on the wing design for high wing loading, as well as a top speed of 925 mmo, as well as the ability to go into difficult airports such as London City with low speed handling characteristics. So this is a category killing aircraft that we're very excited about. And on November 4th, we had a tremendous day. It was a very proud day for Bombardier, its employees, and especially the team that worked so hard to bring this aircraft to first flight. You see in this picture the Global 5000 in the background. We had to use that chase plane because it was the only thing fast enough to keep up with it. And then Ed Grabman, our chief test pilot, who I spoke to directly when he got off the plane, tremendous pilot, said this is one of the smoothest, you know, first flights he's ever encountered. We hit all of the test points. It flew for over 2 hours. It's now been transferred to Wichita, the Learjet site. It has over 30 plus hours of flight and over 10 additional flights, so performing very well. So what I want to do is I have a short video to share with you kind of the emotion and the experience that we all felt on that day. So do I turn it over to you guys for the video? Click.
Clearance for takeoff.
So if that doesn't get excite you, I'm not sure what does. I still love trains, Laurent, so don't get me wrong. So. And then finally, just wrapping up, hopefully you can see a tremendous amount of confidence we have through the execution of what we've done in 2016. We have a clear path for our plan for both 2017 through 2020. We're going to improve our margins through our transformation efforts. We're going to execute the 7,000, which is entering into service, 7,000-8,000 we're entering into service in 2018. And we're going to continue to grow our aftermarket business, which is basically retaining our customer base inclusively. So with that, I want to thank you for the chance to be here with you today. And I'm going to introduce my esteemed colleague, Mr. Fred Cromer, President of Bombardier Commercial Aircraft. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is my pleasure to be up here representing the thousands of Bombardier employees that design, build, and support our commercial aircraft around the world. It's an incredible team. I get the fortunate position of standing here in front of you today to talk about some amazing accomplishments and achievements of this team in 2016 and really kind of set the stage for 2017 and beyond. So today I'll give you an update on our three product lines, but first let's take a look at some of the accomplishments in 2016 and, as I mentioned, looking forward into 2017. 2016 was an incredibly busy year, some amazing accomplishments. Just to name a few, the CS100, we had some additional certifications coming to us in 2016. We certified the CS300. We improved our order book for the C-Series with the addition of Air Canada and Delta. The unveiling of an exciting new interior for the CRJ. Deliveries of both the CS100 and the CS300. And entry into service with Swiss and, as of yesterday, AirBaltic. You know, not to take it for granted, but you know, this family of aircraft is coming at us in very close proximity. So, you know, we put the CS100 into service in June of this year with Swiss. 6 months later to the day, the next member of the family comes into service yesterday with AirBaltic. So I couldn't be more proud of the team in doing this, and I can't think of another program that has introduced two members of the family, not only in 1 year, but in 6 months apart. So next year, we'll certify the CS100 for operations out of London City. We're very excited about that. And we deliver the first CS300 to Swiss. We will also add Korean Airlines to the C-Series family of operators, and there's more to come. So for 2017, we'll see higher revenues for commercial aircraft, up to just under $3 billion in revenue, and improved EBIT performance as we ramp up production of the C-Series. Maintaining our planned C-Series deliveries in the range of 30 to 35 aircraft. This puts us on track to meet our 2020 objectives of $5.5 billion in revenues and becoming positive on an EBIT basis. We have more work to do, but we're very happy with where we are today, and we are extremely excited about the future as we look forward to 2020 and the years beyond. At Commercial Aircraft, we too have our piece of the transformation project. We have very specific objectives as part of the overall Bombardier transformation, including initiatives to address both direct and indirect costs, achieve savings by participating in global work share, and improving our inventory turns. We've also been transforming our team, strengthening our marketing group to connect directly with the fleet planning departments at airlines around the world, and we've recruited some of the most well-known sales professionals in the business. So we are out there talking to airlines every day. We've got a strong team, and we are making those connections happen, and we look forward to increasing the backlog on the C-Series in particular. We have plans specifically on the C-Series to continue to drive down costs and achieve efficiencies, like ensuring low-cost suppliers ramp up to meet our production volumes, and we are gaining in efficiencies as we build more aircraft, reducing the production hours per aircraft and spreading the fixed costs over more and more units or aircraft. This is not new for us, by the way. We have a culture that is really built on continuous improvement. The CRJ program, for example, has gone through several iterations in its life. We've delivered almost 1,900 of those aircraft, and today the production line is probably one of the most efficient in our industry. During the next 5 years and beyond, the long-term fundamentals of our markets continue to support our plan. Economic growth is driving worldwide passenger growth, and oil price volatility, combined with demand for the latest technology, is fueling demand for our products. We maintain our 20-year projection of 5,700 aircraft in the 60 to 100-seat category and 7,000 aircraft in the 100 to 150-seat single-aisle segment. That's 12,700 aircraft. About 5,000 are required just to replace aging aircraft, and the balance of 7,700 aircraft are needed to meet the growing demand in air travel. Our strong and much improved C-Series backlog will be the primary driver of this revenue growth as we approach $5.5 billion in revenue in 2020. That's doubling our revenue in the next 4 years, or a 24% annual growth rate. As I mentioned earlier, next year we deliver approximately 35 C-Series on our way to over 100 aircraft as we look out to 2020 on an annual basis. The good news is that most of this capacity is already sold. We really don't have room for a large order until we sort of get to the back half of 2019, 2020. So I think we feel very good about where we are. We are well on our way to executing on this ramp up. And as we look towards 2020 and beyond, we're pretty excited about what we see. As far as our legacy programs, we continue to see opportunities for the Q400 and the CRJ aircraft around the globe and are leveraging our strong and diverse customer base to add new operators like CityJet supporting SAS with the CRJ 900. We continue to diversify the Q400 platform with our first cargo combi that entered service earlier this year in Japan. And we now also offer a reconfigured cabin that will accommodate up to 90 passengers, the largest turboprop capacity in the industry. And we unveiled the most modern regional jet interior for the CRJ 900 that will allow every passenger to carry on their standard size rollerboard luggage, eliminating the hassle of having to check that baggage at the gate. It's a huge operating advantage for the airlines and certainly a welcome feature for the traveling customers. For the C-Series, more specifically, the 100 to 150-seat market, we see strong demand for this size aircraft around the world. In 2005, there were 6,100 city pairs served by this size aircraft, and that's grown to about 7,300 in 2016. Frankly, the category is underordered given the size of the existing fleet and the current age of this fleet at over 16 years, 16.7 years old to be exact. We think this number could actually be higher with an aircraft like the C-Series that has unit costs that compare to much larger aircraft, and we are generating interest in the C-Series in some of the largest and fastest growing markets. I spent a large part of my career in aviation as a fleet planner at two major airlines in North America. And I can tell you that a smaller aircraft with unit costs that rival much larger aircraft is the most useful, the most powerful tool in the toolbox. And it's something that the fleet planners recognize, and as we continue to introduce this airplane, the interest level is growing. You can use this aircraft to develop new markets, you can use this aircraft to effectively defend existing markets, and you can use this aircraft to increase frequency on markets without having to add a significant amount of capacity because of the size of this airplane. Today, the C-Series has a solid foundation in terms of both funding and orders to capitalize on the real need in this 100 to 150 seat segment. We've strengthened the order book with strong airlines and lessors, and the C-Series is appealing to diverse industry applications, from low-cost operations, point-to-point operations, to more traditional hub-and-spoke operations as well. The economic performance of the C-Series is unmatched, and the interest is growing greater than ever. The momentum is very tangible. The more we show this aircraft and the more we deliver this airplane to our customers, the more interest we generate in this program, and it's very, very exciting. But it's really not just about the economics. The C-Series delivers an unparalleled passenger experience in the single aisle category. And I don't care really what size single aisle aircraft you compare it to. The economics, yes, are outstanding with 18% lower cost per passenger, an incredibly low fuel consumption per passenger, and an impressive range capability. That's what gets the airlines and the fleet planners excited. But the passengers will thank them for it because of the widest seats and the widest aisle in the industry, the large overhead bins, and the huge windows giving this single aisle family wide body appeal. In fact, that's the most common comment I get from people that experience this aircraft, that in a single aisle airplane, we've been able to achieve what feels like a wide body experience. And the industry is taking note. So I could stand up here all day long and talk to you about the attributes and the excitement about this aircraft, but it's much better to actually hear from our customers and recognize what our customers are saying. The C-Series will provide unit costs equal to 180-seat A320neo aircraft. That's from Carsten Spohr, the head of Lufthansa. Superior operating economics, network flexibility, and best-in-class fuel. That's from Ed Bastian, the head of Delta. So again, the customers that are experiencing this aircraft are incredibly excited to get the airplane. They only wish we could deliver more of them and deliver them faster. But I have to tell you, seeing is believing. So like David, I've got a video, and I want to share this video with you today. So in this video, we featured Swiss because a year ago, when we were here, we were talking about certification, that's the next milestone, more orders, that's another milestone, but the real test of this airplane is going to be how does it perform in service. And with several months now of operation at Swiss, I can tell you we couldn't be happier with how well the airplane is doing from a reliability standpoint and certainly from a passenger appeal standpoint. Some of the statistics on this slide, we've flown over 1,600 flights, carried over 150,000 passengers. They've added 18 destinations for this aircraft. It's really changing their product offering, and the customers are incredibly excited about it. And you saw from the video, Swiss is very excited about this airplane and putting it into service. It's been a busy year for Swiss. They also put the 777 in service. That's an airplane that's very well known, well tested, and the reliability of the C-Series is rivaling an airplane that's been around for some time. So we're very, very happy with where we are. Swiss is very happy. And as I turn the page here to the next slide, our next customer, AirBaltic, flying out of Riga, Latvia, is equally as excited about getting this airplane because it's going to change the look of that airline, and they're extremely excited and anticipating a tremendous passenger experience as they introduce the aircraft. This is a picture of the celebration that we did in Mirabel where we build the aircraft. And you know, these delivery events are unbelievable. It's such a proud moment for us, you know, given everything that we've gone through to get this airplane into service. And when you look back at 2016 and what's been accomplished, it's pretty amazing. Boy, what a difference 1 year makes. But you know, as I mentioned earlier, the excitement about this program continues. The more we expose this airplane to the industry, the more conversations we're having. So I think we couldn't be in a better spot as we sit here today and think about 2017 and beyond, even you know, to 2020 when we ramp up to full production. So again, very excited. Thank you very much for your attention. And with that, I think we do the Q&A.
So we'll just set up here. So we'll do, again, running very good on time. So we'll do a question period for the four business unit presidents. They'll be on stage. You know, Alain, John, Jim, and Nico are also available. So maybe let's focus on the BUs per se. And then if you have questions, we'll ask the other leaders to come up on stage. So again, just please raise your hand and on the web submit your questions. We'll start right here. The mic will come.
Steve Wilson, Lapidus Asset Management. In terms of the aerostructures business, I just want to make sure I understand what I heard. So you talked about increasing the size of that business by 50%. You said basically with the current margin you're making about $128 million, that you're going to get $100 million just from the materials savings, and yet we're only talking about a 9 to 11% margin. So the implication there is that there really isn't any, you know, leverage of the SG&A of that operation to hit those kind of numbers. And with that kind of dramatic increase in output and throughput, I'm not sure where that's coming from unless because the bulk of the growth is internal sourcing for, you know, the commercial group and the business jet group, that you're not allowing that business to earn an incremental profit on that. Is that part of it, or is there something else that's holding back the leverage off of all of the efficiencies?
So thank you, first of all, for your question. So a big portion of our growth is going to be on our new program. So with the new program also, I think we've pledged some cost reduction to help you know, both of the C-Series, the Global 7000. So during some of the years of the plan, I think as we drive cost reduction, you don't see the same margin expansion on those new programs. So I think where do we get our growth? In EBIT, we get our growth from the sustaining base, so all the current offering that we have right now. So the transformation is really driving, you know, big margin expansion there. It's also coming from the aftermarket. So this is a segment that has much higher returns than we have on the other. Our challenge, I guess, is, you know, to do better than what we have there on the new programs, on the C-Series Global 7, is to try to accelerate some of our cost reduction beyond the price reduction, but that we've pledged. But this is not really embedded in the plan.
Go in the back.
Yes, thanks. Just wanted to talk a little bit about commercial and business jets. How should we think about the mix of both going forward? So you've guided the ramp in C-Series. How should we think about deliveries for the Q400 and the CRJ family? And sort of a similar question for business transportation. You're going to do 10 deliveries for Lear in 17. Where does that go in 18? What's the future of that product portfolio? And how should we think about mix of sort of, you know, medium biz jets versus large biz jets going forward from here.
So on the commercial aircraft side, for the Q400 and the CRJ, in our five-year plan, we're not assuming dramatic growth in those programs. There's some pressure in the regional business that really is causing us to be a little more conservative in our projections there. There's a potential pilot shortage that people are talking about. And so if you look at our five-year plan, the growth is all driven by the C-Series and really just sort of steady production for the Q400 and the CRJ.
For the business aircraft, the way I'd characterize it is you saw our market share. So, and as the market improves, we're going to make sure we maintain that share. So the growth of the incremental rate will be commensurate with the market share. So we're not going to relinquish share. So that'll equal kind of the similar proportional volumes within, and also the mix spread. For Learjet, you know, we're very proud of the brand. It's a great product. I mean, technically, it's a best-in-class, just very tough price point market. So what we do is continue to make sure that we're matching the volume with the demand requirements, and also, you know, minimizing the impact of some of the pricing pressures in that segment. So we'll continue to monitor Learjet. Again, we're very proud of the brand. It's a great product. And we're going to do the right things from a business perspective long term to either, you know, make sure we make the right decisions for sustaining that business.
Sure thing. And just a follow up on that, any appetite for new development programs at Business Jet, be it sort of a refresh of the Challenger series?
Yeah, always. Alain tells me no, but, you know, right now. But, you know, I guess what I'd say is we have a very clear plan of what we know we're going to do. It's a function of timing, investment, and so forth. So, you know, we're going to make sure we always have fresh products, and we're always going to make sure we maintain our products fresh and make sure we never relinquish any market share in the places we're very strong.
Okay. Thank you.
As a follow-up to that, I guess, on the business jet, if you subtract the $10 billion 2020 and subtract from that the $5 billion that you have in 2017 and the $3 billion on the 7,000, 8,000, that implies $2 billion of growth on the existing base of that $5 billion, or about 40% from where we are today. What drives the growth there other than the market improving?
Well, it's the two components that you left out. One is aftermarket. Right, so we have a certain component of revenue. John talked about $3 billion aggregately, so we're a component of that aftermarket. We're going to basically, what we said, is double our aftermarket revenue in that space, and then we're going to get lift as the market increases. We're going to improve. We're going to take the existing portfolio and increase rate to make sure we maintain our share, as I mentioned earlier.
Bill Mastors from Baird & Company. First question is for Fred. Following up on our conversation at break, you know, if we take a look at the C-Series, we certainly have everything going in your direction as far as industry trends. You just cited the pilot shortage and the upgauging of legacy carriers. You have the Delta, Air Canada orders. You have a stellar sales organization. You have oil prices going up. You have rave reviews. Now, my question is, you know, with everything that you have in place, you've gotten two orders, I think, in 6 months. What's preventing, all right, just a slug of orders from coming in? And then kind of a quick adjunct and follow-up question there would be, what number or how many operators do you think that you have to get to before you start to get an order from, I'll call it, a top seven lessor? So that's my first question. I know it's rather lengthy, so I apologize for that. The second question is for David. David, my question for you is that with all the fractional ownership that we have out there, increasing number of charter services out there, concierge flying, are they replacing or supplementing some of that corporate jet demand? Might they be drawing away from it? If you could comment on that, that would be great. And maybe if you could talk a little bit about maybe the percentage of orders that might be coming from those types of customers, that would be appreciated. And thanks very much.
So in terms of, you know, the order book and what's happening, you know, it's sort of normal course for a new program where you have a certain number of potential customers that jump in early. You have customers that are waiting for certification, and you have certain number of airlines that are waiting to see just, you know, how is the aircraft going to perform in service. With all of this now kind of behind us, as I mentioned, you know, the momentum is tangible. So we find ourselves in conversations all over the world about the airplane. We continue to show the aircraft through demonstration to airlines around the globe. And, you know, the airlines are going to move at their own pace. If I could make them move faster, I would.
But you know, they have their own planning cycles. They have their own way of doing business. And all I can tell you is that we're very optimistic and excited where we are. And when we have something to announce, we will. In terms of sort of the leasing industry, we do have lessor content in the order book today. And you know, having participated in the leasing business for quite some time, the milestones there are really just again, how is the aircraft performing in service? Does it have broad appeal? And so I think we're ticking all those boxes, and we will generate the interest from what I would call more speculative leasing companies that would place an order and then take it upon themselves to go place the aircraft. But that's really our job first, and we're executing on that, as you mentioned, with our sales team and our marketing team around the world. It's our job to lay the foundation. And then we can continue over time to rely on the leasing community to supplement our efforts and place those aircraft. So I think it's coming. And again, I'm very optimistic that this airplane will have broad appeal, given the statistics that I showed you in terms of the application of this aircraft in many different business models and for different uses. So I think we're in great shape. And you know, as these orders come together, whether it's from airlines or from the leasing companies, we'll be sure to announce them.
And the critical mass that might be necessary for a top seven leasing company to place an order, what do you think, 600 orders, 40 operators?
I wouldn't put a number on it. I think the acceptance, the enthusiasm, and the entry into service, when the airlines start talking about the aircraft, and I shared a couple of comments from some of the most well-known leaders in our industry, that starts to gain traction. And that's really going to be the impetus for some airlines that are sitting on the sidelines that maybe don't have, the same capability in terms of fleet planning to kind of, step into the program. So, like I said, I think we're very satisfied with where we are.
Did you have a question for David? Yeah, okay, go ahead.
Yeah, so if I recall your question, so I actually think the fleet operators function very much like commercial aircraft operators. Scale, efficiency, and commonality matter. So what we see there is that, since we're embedded with all the major fleet operators, what they do is they look at their fleet planning, and customers who buy a fraction of a share also buy the newness in the aircraft. So if an older aircraft shows up and they bought a share on a new one, there's a lot of demand from those customers to say, hey, I want more lift on the new aircraft. So what we see is a lot of fleet planning going on for making sure that they're getting the new aircrafts from us, improving the commonality of their fleet, whether it's the 350, 650, or global. And we see, this is a real strategic advantage because we supply, our products to all four major fleet operators.
I'll go to a question online, so for Laurent. With such a high level of reuse on existing platform planned, what is the plan on how development takes place to maintain a competitive platform as technology evolves?
And it's all about innovation. So we bring innovation at three levels. The first one is at the component level, and we do that with our suppliers. And of course, each building block of the platform is being reviewed, and we take into account the upstream technologies. I can give you an example with the silicon carbide, which normally should bring us a significant improvement in energy consumption and reduction of weight. We do that also at the product level, so it could be the train. So here we optimize the overall performances of the train. And I can give you an example about, and the same example, silicon carbide to trains, where we are reducing by more than 15% energy consumption in our trains. And then the third level is at the system level, where you bring an overall innovation, and always the same. We are at the energy level, and you arrive into the integration of the train with the infrastructure, and we optimize the energy power or the power supply with the train, and we provide a total optimization. And energy is one key element of course, of the total cost of ownership. So, and this is how we bring innovation. The second question about our R&D. So it's between 1% and 2%. This is the R&D we fund on the component level. So we have a significant amount of development also into our project that we finance directly through our customer project. But we are also working with our suppliers and our customers in order, of course, to fund together some investment.
Yeah, okay.
Sorry, we'll go a question here, and then Benoit, and then gentleman there.
Hi, David Tyerman from Cormark. So two questions, one for Fred. Fred, I was wondering on the C-Series when we should expect
you to reach what you would consider normal profit level for the airplane. I wouldn't think 2020 numbers are that level. And then for Laurent, you've got a lot of margin momentum right now. I'm just wondering if there are any puts and takes when we're thinking beyond 2017, because you're almost at your target in 2017. So do you surge way beyond it, or is there some things we should keep in mind that may keep you to somewhere closer to the 8%?
Yeah, so the first question in terms of, where are we in terms of kind of reaching that normalized kind of run rate profit level, right now, as you know, we're in the middle of the ramp up. So it's all about kind of getting production up, driving costs down, and our guidance for 2020 really sort of sets the stage for the future. You know, 2020 is where we'll break even on a cash flow basis or on an EBIT basis, and that really sort of sets the stage because we will be at our full production in 2020 and beyond.
Would it take 2 or 3 years? Or?
Well, at this point, I'm not going to make any promises for 2021, 2022, but I think that's a reasonable assumption to sort of start getting that profitability as we, finish the ramp-up phase.
For transportation, Q3 was a good performance. So it's 1 point, so we want to make sure that it is sustained. Next year guidance 7.5, so we go cautiously to that, and what we are looking is beyond 8%. So as we walk, we will try to get as high as possible.
We have Benoit.
Okay, thank you, Benoit from Desjardins. My question is for Dave. Just wondering whether there's an opportunity to bring back the Learjet 85 over time, whether it's an opportunity for a business jet aircraft. And the second question is related to the ramp up of the Global 7000, what we should expect in terms of dilution, and if your margins going forward take into account the potential write-off, given the spending might be well away ahead of initial expectation.
First answer is no. No plan to bring back the 85 based on the cancellation of that. Second question, everything in our plan has the ramp up baked in, the unit costs associated with it. Your reference to a write-off because you said right now we're not overrunning any of our budget on the 7,000, so there wouldn't be a perceived write-off. So we're right on our plan, and all the units that are the initial delivery units and any costs associated with them are already baked into our 8 to 10% margin during that time frame.
Okay, thanks.
Cool. I think the mic is should be there. Then we'll go here, third row, please, Francois.
Yeah, thanks, guys. It's just Steve at Raymond James. Given some of the challenges that surfaced this past fall related to the engine, what kind of cadence should we expect for the delivery pattern next year for the C-Series? If you could provide any color, that'd be great. And maybe just a broader update on where you see that issue in the supply chain.
Sure. In terms of the deliveries, we have all the confidence in the world that Pratt is going to achieve the ramp up. Obviously, there were some issues this year, so we had to push some deliveries out of 2016. But we're maintaining our production levels for next year in the range of 30 to 35. So I have confidence that Pratt's going to solve the issue. We're working with them now, and so I think we feel pretty good about 2016.
In terms of cadence, then, for us of us that have to stick numbers in a model, is it going to be pretty back-end weighted? How should we think about that ramp up?
The ramp up just generally is a little bit back-end weighted for 2016, 2017, excuse me. But again, it's fairly steady throughout the year. I mean, we have a plan, that kind of achieves milestones every 6 months, and we're going to stick to that plan so that we're not behind the ramp up in 2018 and beyond, as an example.
Okay, thanks.
Yul.
Good morning, Yul Mabev at JP Morgan. My first question is on transportation. As you look at the 2016 performance and you look at the 2017 guidance, how is that tracking relative to the LACASS performance targets that were set? And then my second question is on business jets. If you look at the 135 deliveries expected for 2017, what portion of that is already booked?
So the first answer is simple. It's in line with LACASS commitment. So we are on the right path to achieve as per their investment.
If you look at that relative to some of the portion of equity that they were having, how's that moving along?
What do you mean by that?
You mean the 30%?
Exactly.
Stake?
Yeah. The 30% stake. There were some performance targets where the portion would increase or decrease depending on performance of the business. How is that tracking?
We're tracking to plan. I guess that's at this stage. We're very early in the game. It's been less than a year. So you can assume that 30% for now. We'll go question from the web.
He had a question.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, so what I mentioned in my presentation was that we have a gross book-to-bill approaching one. We normally don't talk about backlog as far as in the fiscal year, but what I will say is we're actively selling into 2017, and we'll be in a better position in 17 than we were starting calendar year 16, or fiscal year 16.
Okay. We'll take one from the web, and then there's one on the left there. So it's a question for Fred. Recently, when your competitors pushed out the entry into service of a new regional jet model due to U.S. scope clause or lack of U.S. Scope law changes, where do you stand on that issue and where do you see opportunities?
So it's something we follow pretty closely. And over the next several years, we don't really see momentum or effort to really change where those scope clause limitations are today. For us, that's fine because our regional jets fit well within the scope clause requirements. And so as far as the CRJ family is concerned, there's no issue. We're not dependent on any kind of scope clause changes for the CRJ program. So, I think that's something that, the industry likes to watch. I think it's pretty risky to develop an airplane that's dependent on scope clause changes, but that's not the situation for us in the CRJ family.
Okay, we have a question there, and then Seth.
So George Ferguson from Bloomberg Intelligence. A BizJet question and a transportation question. On BizJets, David, as you ramp up 7,000 deliveries, can you speak to the number of deliveries you'll get out in sort of 18, 19, and can you talk to what your assumptions are vis-a-vis the 650, whether you're taking market share away from Gulfstream, whether you see pent-up demand in that part of the business, so that you think you can both grow to those levels? Go ahead and do that, and I'll go transportation.
Yeah, so we normally don't talk about our ramp-up profile, but what I will say is, we're sold out, through 2020, so we're meeting our customer requirements based on the purchase agreements. We think that segment's going to have some headroom for both. The 7,000 is a distinctly different aircraft than the 650. It's four zones. It's a bigger aircraft. The 650 is three zones, a shorter aircraft. We're going to be 7,400 nautical miles plus minus 5%. As we fly and improve our performance, we'll see if we can extend that. So I think we're going to create a space, that's a bit of a differentiator. And a lot of our customers that have purchased a 7,000, had access to buy a 650. They didn't because of the distinctiveness of the 7,000. So we think we're going to both create new customers as well as probably take some from Gulfstream, as well as, live within that space between the two OEMs.
And no margin dilution or no price pushing, lower prices because of that 650?
No, because I think, like I said, our aircraft's very different, right? So, it's a brand new point design. It's distinctively different. So, we're going to maintain our pricing in that space. If they want a three-zone cabin to go 7,500 nautical miles, they can buy a 650. If they want four zones to go that and have a stateroom in the back, a bed, potential shower, again, it's a very different platform that you're paying for to live in this space.
Thanks. So on the transportation side, as I think about your business, I think about a lot of new volume coming out of Asia, especially sort of China, big population centers. I know the Chinese typically like to be involved in those projects. I think you're in joint ventures in China. And so as that business progresses, how do you continue to grow margin and take share in a world where the Chinese will want to learn from what you're doing and then market it as well around the world?
This is very simple. In fact, we've been in China for many years already, more than 15 years, and we have grown there, and we continue to grow with them. So we have a very successful joint venture there that address, in fact, most of the market segment. So we are on the light rail, on the metro, and the intercity. And we have to continuously improve the overall performance there as well. So it's moving fast. It's sometimes it's moving faster than elsewhere on the planet. And so, and we are today, the, as I said to you, the largest non-Chinese player in the rail industry there. So, and this is also where the partnering approach we have had with Chinese is very important for us as well. So we see that with a very, very strong momentum for us. And we are uniquely placed to play the partnering approach in the China ecosystem.
And you think that could persist? Yep.
Sorry, we'll just move on maybe for Seth. Sorry about that. We also have available John and Alain and the team, so if you have other questions more financially, we're going to wrap it up in a few minutes, so maybe we'll go on to your question next.
Sure. Just actually to follow up closely on that last question, I think Alain had made a comment on the last call about potentially doing more globally with the Chinese. And so, I mean, do you see this as part of your global strategy, Laurent, as taking the partnerships that you have in China and working with them in places outside of China and around the world?
So the starting point is always the ecosystem where you start from. So in the ecosystem, you need to find the right partner to play with. So as far as we are concerned, we are partnering with many different type of players. So the Chinese now are playing in different ecosystem, and we want to be with them where they are bringing a strong value there. So it was the case in the past in China. So we have done a very, very strong development with them. But they also position themselves in country and ecosystem we were not. And we want to be with them there. So we want to leverage their positioning and to partner with them there so that we can continuously grow the business.
I mean, would you see them as your leading partner globally can, going forward, if you think out through the planning period to 2020?
Here again, it depends on the different investment that you will have in the different ecosystem. But I would give you some example about cities that are developing and are bringing new metro system, where you go for a complete turnkey solution, and where we can partner with the Chinese and deliver the full turnkey to the city. And they are bringing their capabilities. We are bringing our unique experience and technology, and the combination of the two is a very powerful proposal to some cities. And it is the case, for instance, in some Asian cities where they have their strengths and we have ours.
And just as a transportation follow-up, you know, management for a long time at Bombardier has talked about a sort of long-term guideline of transportation free cash flow being broadly in line with EBIT in the segment. Is that something that is that a goal that you met in our meeting in 2016 and also expect to meet in 2017?
Yes, it is.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, sorry, that question, John, do you want to start? Was that a question, Seth? Sorry, I didn't get.
He answered.
Oh, okay, you got it. Okay, perfect. Very good. Okay, excellent. I didn't hear the answer. I guess next one, was it for John or Alain, your question? Okay, well, you can ask a question now. They'll come on stage.
Okay, thanks. For Alain, there were two themes that have been discussed in the past that you didn't really touch on today. I was wondering if you could elaborate on these. First, on the aerospace side, the Russia and Chinese market, and accessing those markets through an industrial policy of production in those markets. And the second, in transportation, broader industry consolidation on the transportation market. To what extent is execution along those fronts or changes on those fronts required to achieve your plan for 2020?
Well, right now our plan is assume that we perform on a standalone basis with no other strategic initiatives. So that's the base plan that you're seeing today. When it comes to access to the Chinese market, for example, through industrial collaboration, I mean, we already have a lot. I mean, Laurent just mentioned our very large presence on the train side, but as well, I mean, we're working very closely with AVIC already on some of our commercial aircraft. So we do have that access today, and obviously we're leveraging that. I mean, Fred and David and the team are leveraging that as they're in discussion with potential customers. We keep an eye on the train side, on potential industry consolidation. It's a very competitive landscape today. We have seen some merger on the Chinese side. And that's something that we pay attention to. Having said that, I think that we spent a lot of time in 2016 to really understand how can we compete, successfully compete on a standalone basis. And that is the reason why you're seeing all these actions, you know, in motion today, because we believe now that we have the best product portfolio. I mean, we have a great presence. Our access to customers through the various channels are very solid. So we feel good. So we're going to keep looking at the portfolio. We're going to keep looking at potential strategic initiatives. We're going to do them only if they add value to what we're presenting today.
Okay, so just to be clear, if you make progress on those fronts, that would be an upside to your existing plan?
Yes, it would.
Thank you.
I'll go to a question on the web for John. Can you talk a little bit about the free cash flow by quarters for 2017?
I'm not sure. Can you guys hear me or do I need a mic?
Oh, sure, work.
Okay. So the question was on free cash flow by quarter?
Yes, free cash flow by quarter for 17. Just make sure his mic is on.
Okay, thanks. So I guess we don't typically provide the guidance by quarter, but in a nutshell, what you should look at in terms of 2017 is Q1 will be the highest consumption quarter. Q4 will obviously be the best performing quarter. That's typical seasonality. Some of the things to consider in there is that the train business, I think, will gain momentum in terms of sales profitability and that profitability driving cash flow in the second half of the year. Also, we talked a little bit about the C-Series natural ramp in the back end of the year, so we'll have more deliveries in the back. We'll keep, you know, driving that production rate, so we'll be building a little bit of inventory in the front end. And the other one that's important specifically in 17, I'd say, is that we're in the heart of the development program for the 7000 on the flight test, so building hardware and vehicles and so on and so forth. So we'll be adding some cash usage the way I described it, but it'll come in the front half. I think, you know, a good chunk of that Q1 as well. So those are kind of the elements. Q1, the deepest quarter. Q4 should be a positive, solid quarter. And brings us to the 750 to the billion for the year. The restructuring will play in there a little bit. It's kind of hard exactly to time the cash payments on that. My suspicion is that Q1 will be, you know, a fairly good cash outflow quarter for restructuring. We'll get a lot of things done. And then probably near the back end of the year for 2018 action. So we'll get probably some 17 Q4 spend as well.
Okay. David, you got a question?
There's a question right there.
Maybe just one last question after that, and we'll conclude.
Yes, there's a question right there.
Hi, David Tyerman. So a question on RVGs. So just doing some math, and I may have the numbers wrong because I don't have the financials in front of me from last year. But I think you had around $2.5 billion of RVGs. So if we use the SkyWest as a model, it sounds like you could have $1 billion of cash going out in the next 10 years, ballpark. So if you could just comment on that. And just related to the RVGs, how are we actually going to see this? Is this going to go through the operating segments in restructuring line, or how will we actually see that?
How it's going to go through on the in terms of payments, I'd have to look at that. I'm not sure, probably other liabilities. And so in terms of the expense itself, we provision for that. So we have provisions. We assess those provisions every year. And they typically go in. It will go through the segment P&L, absolutely. It'll hit the business unit. So in terms of RVGs, most of them are commercial, go through a BU at commercial. So it'll be in their margins, has been their margins. You've seen that we've built up to, I think it's about $600 million of provisioning up to now. All of that has gone through the commercial business unit margin, and that's what we would do it going forward. In terms of your number, I think the RVG-specific piece of it is about 1.7. Expect that to come down considerably with the SkyWest. Plus, we continue to work these on a case-by-case basis, right? So SkyWest happens to be a larger deal, but we do have smaller ones that do get settled and solved and so on and so forth as we go. So my expectation is that we'll see when we report out in Q4 this year, for the full year, we'll see a reduction of that RVG liability from the 1.617 level down probably $300 million or so. And I think, you know, what we're doing is we're resolving them, I think, at a discount, which is showing that the entire liability is not going to turn into cash outflows. You mentioned $1 billion. I won't speculate. I mean, that's a long time frame and a lot of different cases and negotiation and circumstances and values and so on and so forth to consider. What I can tell you is that when we built the five-year plan,
you know, we spent, I think, if I'm not mistaken, in 15 or we spent about $100 million. And if you look at the SkyWest deal, it's a pretty big deal. That's kind of $100 million. So more or less, that's the kind of pace we've been running. And we've been able to manage that within our normal cash flows. My expectation is at least over the next 5 years, where I can see more clearly that that's a good kind of pace to be thinking about. And when we look at our own planning, liquidity, or free cash flows, we have that kind of a model in mind. We do look at each one independently. There's different circumstances on how they get paid, so there's some complexity around that. But in the big picture, that's the kind of number I'd look at.
Okay, that's very helpful. And then I just wanted to clarify, the working cap for 2017, looking at your diagram, it looks like it's about the same, except for opposite sign, as the restructuring. So am I looking at 250, 300 million of cash being generated by working cap this year?
Yeah, so let me kind of summarize everything I said in the presentation. $300 million of cash improvement from programs. Those are the two major aerospace programs, largely working capital related, because the C-Series comes down a lot in working capital, global will go up. So the net of that is about 300. On the element, so if you look at that chart, the one that you're thinking about, it's the first box. It's called programs. There's a cash piece, significant working capital improvement there. The other piece is that box that offsets the restructuring. That's the one you're talking about. That's coming from both trains and legacy. It's about 150 million. And the reason that it's 150 is this year in 2016, we'll spend about 150 in cash for restructuring. I'll spend 300 or so next year, the differential being the incremental cash usage, so about $150 million year over year, $300 million in absolute, okay? And the working capital will improve $150 million year over year, so it'll kind of neutralize the impact on cash for 17.
All right, well, I want to thank you, everyone. This concludes our question period. Thank you very much to all of you to attend, to being online. Thank you to our presenters. The webcast will be available, you know, tomorrow on our website. So thanks again. Thank you. And I'll just give some details about the lunch in a few minutes as well. So just maybe for the lunch, it's going to be served in the Empire Room, just I think across the hall. We have, you can sit wherever you want. Our presenters will be seated at different places, so you'll see some reserved signs. And during the lunch, you'll probably walk around. So if there's no one on your table when you start, don't worry. They'll make their way during lunch. And so feel free to ask questions. Hope the day was very helpful. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.